In this question, which of the given number has its IEEE 754 32-bit floating point representation as this? Okay, so we have given this complete information about the 32-bit floating point representation in the IEEE 754 representation. Okay, so in the IEEE 754 representation, there are three parts actually. There are three parts. So if I am talk about the first part, so first part which is having only one bit, it is for the sign bit. Okay, so this is sign bit. Now there are two more parts. The second part which is of having 8 bits and it is for exponent. Okay, so exponent of the decimal equivalent. This is exponent and this is for the mantissa. So for the mantissa there are 23 bytes, because 8 plus 1 9 and 9 plus 23, this is complete 32, and this is called the mantissa. Okay, so in the IEEE 754, it is using one simple format which is actually minus 1 to the power sign bit. This is sign bit, so I am using here minus 1 to the power sign. This is actually decimal equivalent of this IEEE 754 32 bit representation. So minus 1 to the power sign bit into actually this is mantissa. So here this mantissa or this complete thing is in the normalized form, and in the normalized form first bit will be 1, first there is 1 point, okay, 1, or this is decimal, and then come this mantissa. Okay, so 1 point mantissa, since this is in the normalized form which is used by IEEE 754 representation. So 1 point mantissa into this is 2 to the power, this is exponent. Okay, so exponent will be come in 2 to the power, but since this is the biased, this exponent is in the biased form, so we have to subtract 127 from this exponent. So whatever the value or whatever the decimal equivalent of this binary exponent, we have to subtract 127 from this, since this is biased 127 form. This is IEEE 754, which is biased 127. So 2 to the power exponent, which is in the decimal format, minus 127. Okay, so this is the complete decimal equivalent of this binary representation. So in this we have given sign bit as 0, so I am using directly here minus 1 to the power 0, which means it is positive, into 1 point. What is mantissa? Mantissa is this 8 bits for exponent, and this here it starts, mantissa starts from this one. So 1.11, and then there are so many zeros. Okay, so I am not putting all the zeros here. Let's suppose there are these many zeros. Okay, so 1 point, this is mantissa, into 2 to the power exponent minus 127. So since exponent is of 8 bit, so 1 and these 7 times 0, 1 2 3 4 5 6 and 7, this is complete 8 bit exponent, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. So now if I calculate the decimal equivalent of this binary, it is actually 128, since this is the this is 2 to the power 0, 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and this is 2 to the power 7. Okay, and this 2 to the power 7 is equals to 128. So 2 to the power exponent, which is 128 minus 127 here. Okay, so what will it give the value? Minus 1 to the power 0, which is plus 1. So I am not writing here plus 1 and 1 anything. Now this is 1.11000. So we know how to convert this into the, this is binary, actually this is binary, 1 point, all this binary, and I have to convert this into the decimal equivalent. So 1 is complete, so I am writing here 1 plus, now this is this 1, these two ones are present after the decimal, so this is the value of 2 to the power minus 1's place. Okay, and the weightage of this bit is 2 to the power minus 2, this is minus 2, okay, this is 2 to the power minus 3, this is 2 to the power minus 4. Since all these bits are after the decimal, so the weightage here is 2 to the power minus 1, 2 to the power minus 2, and so on. So since this 1 is present in the 2 to the power minus 1, so I am taking here 1 into 2 to the power minus 1, which is actually 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 here, plus the next bit is also 1. So 1 into the weightage of this bit is 2 to the power minus 2. So 1 by 2 to the power 2, which is 4. The third bit is 0 and weightage of this is 2 to the power minus 3. So since this is 0 and anything which multiplied by 0, it going to be 0. So all the bits will be 0 here. Okay, so we are not taking all 0 part here. And in the last, so I am not taking this complete thing. And in the last, this is into 2 to the power 128 minus 127, which is 1. So if we calculate this, 1 plus 1 by 2 was plus 1 by 4, which is 1 plus 0.5 plus 0.25, it will give 1.75. okay, so 1.75 into 2, so which is actually 3.5 actually, sorry, 1.75 into multiplied by 2 is it will give 3.5. so answer is 3.5 here. okay, so this is the answer. In this question, the range of integers that can be represented by an n bit 2's complement number system is. So in this, they are talking about the 2's complement number system. So in the 2's complement number system, let's suppose there are 3 bits present. So what is the range of these 3 bits 2's complement numbers? So what is the minimum number or negative number, and what is the maximum number can be represented in the this 3 bit using the 2's complement number? So let's suppose these 3 bits can consider in these 3 combinations: 000, 001, 010, 011, 100, 101. This is 110 and then 111. So these 8 numbers are present here. These 8 combinations are present here. And the 0, okay, the first bit, which is the MSB, it is saying the sign bit also. Okay, so since these 4 bits are sign as 0, so these 4 are positive numbers and these 4 are the negative numbers. Okay, and we know one thing also, that 2's complement numbers are the weighted code. Okay, so what is the meaning of this weight? Actually, this weight means this is the 2 to the power 0, this is 2 to the power 1, and this is 2 to the power 2. Okay, this is the place. Okay, now if this is 0, okay, if this is 0, this is 0, then 0 into 2 to the power 0, so this complete will be the 0. Now this is 1, which is 1 also, this is 2, and this is 3. Why? Because 1 into 2 to the power 1 plus 1 into 2 to the power 0, so this is 3. Now whenever the first bit is 1 in the 2's complement number system, so we have to take minus here. So minus 1 into 2 to the power 2, which is the weightage of this bit. This is 2 to the power 2 place. Okay, so minus 1 into 2 to the power 2 plus 0 into 2 to the power 1 plus 0 into 2 to the power 0, which is, this is complete, this is 0 and this is 0, and this is minus 4. So this combination represent the minus 4. Similarly, this is minus 4 plus 1, so it will represent minus 3. This is minus 4 plus 2, so this will represent minus 2, and this is minus 4 plus 1, minus 4 plus 2 plus 1, so basically this is minus 1. So you can see here, from this 3 bit 2's complement number, we can represent value as minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, and then 3. Okay, so this is the for the 3 bit 2's complement number. So we can generalize here, for n bit, this is basically minus 2 to the power this 3, because 3 bits are there, so 3 minus 1 minus, okay, and then 2, this is 2 to the power 3 minus 1 and then minus 1. Okay, so this is the range, 2 to the power 3 minus 1 minus 1, from here to here. So we can generalize here, minus 2 to the power n minus 1 this is the least number possible here, to 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. So this will be our answer. Okay, so answer is A here. Okay, now one more interesting thing is, this is 0. Okay, so this is 1, now this is 1. The 2's complement of this number 001, 2's complement of this pattern will give me minus 1. Okay, because complement number system is having the negative value in the complement form. For example, this is 001, so let's suppose we want to convert its 2's complement, so it will be 1, then these two bits will be flipped, 1 1. So this is the 2's complement number of this. So this 2's complement number of this, it will represent minus 1. So in this table also we proved that this is represented minus 1. Again, if you want to represent minus 3, then you have to take this 3 and find the 2's complement of this. So 2's complement of this will be 1 0 1. Okay, this is 2's complement of this number, and this will represent 101 will represent minus 3. So here also this 101 represent minus 3. So this is right. Okay, so this is the range of 2's complement number system, minus 2 to the power n minus 1 to 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. So this will be our answer. In this question, how many 32K cross 1 RAM chips are needed to provide a memory capacity of 256 kilobytes? Okay, so what is the meaning of here 256 kilobytes? Basically, this 256 kilobytes, it means there is 256 kilo addresses. Okay, so 256 memory locations or memory addresses, or these lines are 256 kilo, and in each line we can store 1 byte. So basically 1 byte means 8 bits of data we can store in these 256 kilo memory locations. So we have to design the memory which is having the capacity of this 256 kilobytes. So how many 32K cross 1 RAM chips are needed? So there are 32K cross 1 RAM. It means in the 1 RAM, let's suppose this is 1 RAM. So in this 1 RAM, there are 32K or 32 kilo addresses can be present. So there are these 32 kilo lines will be present in this 1 RAM. And in this each row, we can store only 1 bit. This is the meaning of 32K cross 1 bit. 1 RAM. Okay, 32K cross 1 RAM, it means there are 32K locations, and in each location we can store only 1 bit. So now we have to answer this, how many this much size RAMs will be needed to provide this much capacity. So simply, since we have to generate 256 kilo 8 byte or kilobyte 8 bit, okay, so we will directly do here 256 kilo into 8 bit, this much memory capacity we have to generate. So I'll divide by one RAM's capacity, or capacity of the one RAM, which is 32 kilo. Okay, 32 kilo into 1 bit. So this will give me the number of required RAM chips. Okay, so this K to K, it will cancel out this bit. Now you can easily calculate this, 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 3, which is 2 to the power 11 divided by 2 to the power 5, it will give 2 to the power 6. It means we have needed 64. Okay, we needed 64 this 32K cross 1 RAM chips required to provide this much capacity. So answer is 64 here. In this question, a modulus 12 ring counter requires a minimum of. So what is the meaning of this ring counter here? Ring counter is basically the synchronous flip-flops. We can design the ring counter. For example, this is one ring counter. Here, let's suppose this is input. Okay, so this is input. These all are the D flip-flops. Okay, and in this D flip-flop, these are the synchronous. So same clock pulse will be provided to each flip-flop. Okay, now this output of this, okay, output of this will be provided as an input to this flip-flop. This is, let's suppose, D1, this is D2, and if output of this is provided input to the first flip-flop or output of the last. Okay, so output of the last flip-flop will be provided as input to the first flip-flop, then it is called the ring counter. Since this is same as ring, okay, so this is called the ring counter. Okay, and this is Q naught, Q2, sorry, and this is Q2 naught, this is Q1 and this is Q1 naught. Now if we design this 2-bit ring, the ring counter using two flip-flops, then it will only calculate or it will only compute the modulus 2 counter. Okay, it will compute only modulus 2 counter. If we will design the ring counter using 3 flip-flops, then it will compute only modulus 3. So basically, if we will design the ring counter using n flip-flops, then if let's suppose this is n flip-flops, we are designing the ring counter using this n flip-flops, then it can be able to calculate modulus n. Okay, so it can be calculate modulus n or mod n counter. So if we have to design modulus 12 ring counter, then 12 flip-flops will be needed here. So answer is 12. In this question, the complement of the Boolean expression this AB, B complement C plus AC. Okay, so in this question we have to find the complement of this, and for finding the complement we should know the De Morgan's law. And the De Morgan's law says if this AB and we have to complement of this AB, it will give A complement, and this sign and sign will be changed into OR sign. So A complement OR plus B complement, and same as A plus B, if we have to find the whole complement here, it will give A complement and this plus sign will be changed into AND sign and then B complement. Okay, so now we have to find the complement of this. So A, B AND, this is AND sign. Now B complement C, this is OR A, C, and whole complement we have to find. So for finding the whole complement, first this AB complement will be occur. So AB complement, okay, so this complement, this AND sign will be changed into OR sign. So AB complement plus, and now this whole complement, so this is B complement C plus AC whole complement. Okay, so if we are applying De Morgan's law again, then this is AB whole complement, it will give A complement, this AND sign will be changed into OR sign, then B complement, so A complement plus B complement. Okay, so I can combine it together, plus this complete complement, it will give this complement and this complement. So B bar or B complement C, okay, this into AC whole complement, it will give like this. Okay, so we can put here also. Now A complement plus B complement plus this is B complement C here. Okay, actually B complement C whole complement, because this is complement. Okay, so now B complement C whole complement, it will give B plus C complement, and here AC whole complement, it will give A complement plus C complement. So final answer is A complement plus B complement plus B plus C complement into A or dot, not into, it is AND actually. So not A or A complement plus C complement. So answer is this. In this question, the code which uses 7 bits to represent a character is, okay, so ASCII code. ASCII code is actually the 7 bits code, and it will use the 7 bits to represent its code. Okay, so for ASCII code there are totally 128 combinations, and each one combination can represent one unique code. So there could be 128 different codes, is different representation is possible in the ASCII code. Okay, so ASCII code uses the 7 bits to represent a character. Now this is BCD, and BCD code is not uses as a 7 bits. In the BCD we only need 4 bits, okay, to represent any BCD digit, binary coded decimal or binary coded digit. Now EBCDIC, it is also not used as 7 bits, and gray counter or gray code is also not used 7 bits. Okay, so answer is ASCII here. In this question, we have given this expression. Okay, so we have given this expression, and we have to tell, or we have to identify minimum number of 2 cross 1 multiplexers required to realize the following function f equals to a, this one, and assume that inputs are available only in true form. So only a and b and c, these true forms are available, and the constant variable 1 and 0 are also present or also available for us. So we need to design this. So first of all, I am using this f equals to a complement b complement c plus a complement b complement c complement. So if I'll take this a complement b complement common, so it will give a complement b complement c plus c complement. This value is always 1, so it will be actually a complement b complement. Now this is a complement b complement, and since we have to design this using 1 2 cross 1 multiplexers, okay. So if this is on 2 cross 1 multiplexer, let's suppose that this is the selection line, and I am giving as B here, okay, or A here, anything I can give. Let's suppose I am giving A here. So if I am giving A here, so this is, now let's suppose this is B complement, and since this B complement is not available, okay, let's suppose this B complement is available for us. So B complement here, and here I am giving 0. So this multiplexer will give me A complement B complement plus A into, or A and 0. So A and 0 means 0. So finally it will give me A complement B complement, which is required function f. So to design this, we need this one multiplexer, and for this B complement, now again we required one multiplexer for this B complement. So how can we design B complement here? For B complement, let's suppose this is 2 cross 1 multiplexer. For designing B complement, I will give selection line B here, and here I will give input as 1, here I will give input as 0. So this function will give me B complement and 1, or this is plus B and 0. So finally this is B complement, okay. So for generating this B complement, I required 1 2 cross 1 multiplexer, and for now generating this complete function A complement B complement, I required this 2 cross 1 multiplexer. So total number of 2 cross 1 multiplexers required here to realize this complete function is 2. Okay, so these two are the multiplexers required. In this question, we have given this representation, okay, binary we have given this function, okay, or this expression, and we have to tell the number of ones in the binary representation of this, okay. So this is our given function, 3 into 4096 plus 15 into 256 plus 5 into 16 and plus 3, okay. So I can write this as, this is 3 into 16 to the power 0 actually, okay. This is 16 to the power 1. This 256 is 16 to the power 2, or 16 square equals to 256, and 16 cube equals to 4096, okay. So I can write this complete expression as 3 into 16 to the power 3, or 16 cube, plus 15 into 16 square, plus 5 into 16 to the power 1, plus 3 into 16 to the power 0. Okay, so this is complete expression. Now you can assume this complete expression as a, in the if it is written in the hexadecimal form, okay. So if it is written in the hexadecimal form, so 3, this 15 in the hexadecimal will represent like f, for f 3f, then 5, and then this is 3. So this is written in hexadecimal. Why it is written as hexadecimal? Because if we convert this into the decimal, it will give me exact same this expression, 3 into 16 to the power 0 plus 5 into 16 to the power 1 plus this f means 15 into 16 square and this 3 into 16 cube. Okay, so this is the hexadecimal. And now in the hexadecimal we can easily calculate the number of ones present. So each hexadecimal digit, each digit in the hexadecimal can be represented by the 4 bit binary number individually. So this 3 is 0011 in the binary, this f will be 115 and 15 is 1111 in the binary, then this 5 is 0101 in the binary and this 3 is again 0011. So now this complete number or this expression will converted into binary and it will be same like this. Now we can count the number of ones in this binary representation. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10. So 10 is the number here, number of ones in the binary representation. So answer is 10 here. In this question, we have given the Boolean expression. This is the Boolean expression. And we have to tell or we have to identify this Boolean expression is independent of the Boolean variable of which. Okay. So if this is the expression AB plus AB complement plus A complement C plus AC, this is Boolean expression which is given. Okay. Now if I will take A as common from these two terms, so this will give A and then B plus B complement here. Okay. Now again I can take C as common here, so if I am taking C as common, so it will give A complement plus A, or I can take this A complement plus A. And we know that A plus A complement, the value of this is 1 always, and B plus B complement also this value is 1, so this will completely like A plus C. So our given Boolean expression AB, this corresponds to A plus C. Okay, so we can clearly see that this Boolean expression, if we minimize it is independent of the variable B. So answer here is B. In this question, if the sequence of operations push 1, push 2, so these are the sequence of operations we have given, and we have to tell what are the output or what will be print if we perform these sequence of operations in one stack. Okay, so let's suppose this is one stack and we have already this stack S. Now first we are pushing 1, so whenever I push elements into the stack, it will be pushed onto the top of the stack. Okay, so in this scenario, in the beginning stack is empty, so our top is pointed to the minus 1 position, means the stack is empty. Okay, so whenever we have to push the element into the stack, we have to increment the top. Okay, so variable or value of the top will be top will be incremented and then that element will be pushed. Okay, so this is top. Now top is incremented, so top plus plus will be performed, and in this position which is of 0, let's suppose this stack is implemented by array. Okay, so now in the index 0 position, this push 1 will be performed. So now top of the stack TOS will be here, or top will be here in the 0th index. Okay, so this is 1, this is 2 and all these. Okay, now again we are performing push 2. So push 2 means in again top will be incremented and push will be performed here. So this is second element and top will be incremented here. Okay, so now top is pointed in the first position of the array. Then we are performing pop. Okay, so whenever we are performing pop, this element, this top of the stack, okay, so element which is pointed by the top of the stack will come out from the stack and it and the value of this will be printed. Why? Because popped out values we have to print. So in the question, so now 2 will be printed first. Okay, so now this element is now empty, or this cell is empty of the stack. So again this is empty and top will be decremented to this position. It means top will be here now. Okay, so now this is not top. Okay, now this cell is also empty. Again we are performing push 1. So push 1 means top again will be incremented and 1 will be inserted into this position. okay. So now push 2, so top again will be incremented, so top will be come here and push 2, so push 2 performed here, and then we are popping 3 times, okay. So pop pop pop, it means 3 element from top of the stack. If this is the top in this scenario, so from top of the stack 3 elements will be popped out from the stack. So first this 2 will be popped out, and the value of top will be decremented here. So we are printing 2 here since this is popped out. Now again this element is 1 and we are performing pop, okay. So in the pop operation again top this value will be this value will be popped out from the stack, so 1 will be printed and top will be decremented by 1 position from here to here. So now again top will be pointed here, okay, and this element, this is also empty cell. Now again this pop operation, so again 1 will be printed and top will be pointed here, okay, in the minus 1 position. It means after this pop operation stack will be empty, completely empty, okay. So this is so stack will be completely empty. Now we are performing push 2, so again top will be incremented and in this cell 2 will be come, okay. So 2 will be pushed into this cell. Now popper performed, so again 1 we have pushed and then again we are performing pop, so again this 2 will be printed here. So finally this is the sequence of popped out values, so 2 2 1 1 2 is the right answer here. In this question, a machine needs a minimum of 100 seconds to sort 1000 names by quick sort. So we have to pay attention in these terms like minimum and here quick sort, okay. So minimum means it is considering the best case time complexity for the quick sort, and we know the best case of quick sort algorithm. So we know the time complexity of quick sort, which is in the best case, and in the average case it is order of n into log of n. So this is the best case complexity of the quick sort, and in the worst case, if I am talking about the worst case, so in the worst case of quick sort it will take order of n square, okay. But here in the question we are considering the minimum, okay. So it is taking the minimum time. It means we have to use here best case time complexity of the quick sort algorithm. So now it is taking 100 second to sort 1000 names by quick sort. The minimum time needed to sort 100 names will be approximately, okay. So we have given the time required for the quick sort, which is order of n log n equals to, okay. So order of n log n, it is actually constant, some constant k into n into log of n, and this time, this complete time we have given as 100 seconds, okay. So now we can put the value of this k into, we don't know this k constant, but yeah, this n we know 1000 names, so we are putting here 1000, and then log of, this is n log n, okay, n log n. So 1000 into log of 1000 equals to 100 seconds. So now we can calculate the value of k from this equation. So k equals to 100 divided by 1000 into log of 1000, okay. So this 20 will be striked out from here, so now it will give 1 by 10 into log of 1000, and here this log is base 2 actually, okay. So all the logs here are base 2 log. So now this is the value of k, okay. So this is value of k, and now we have to find what is the time needed to sort 100 names here. So for sorting the 100 names, it will take k into 100 log 100 minimum time, okay. The minimum time here it is saying, so for the minimum time we are taking the best case here, so k into 100 log this, and we can put the value of k from this above equation, 1 by 10 into log 1000 this is log 1000 base 2 and into 100. So I'm putting here 100 into log of 100 base 2. Okay, so now we can cut, okay, this value. So now log 2 base 100 divided by log 2 log 1000 base 2. Okay, so this will give the value log 100 divided by log 1000. Okay, so this will give me value of around it will give around 0.66. okay, so it will give value around this whole term, it will give value around 0.666. okay, and here this 10 is left, so into 10. Okay, so now we can calculate here. If this is 0.666, let's suppose this is 0.66, so I have to take this and this, so it will something around 6.66. okay, so this will give me value around 6.666 seconds. So our similar answer here is option B, 6.7 seconds. So this is the answer. In this question, 6 files F1, F2, F3 and these F6 have 100, 200 and these many records respectively. Okay, so in this question it is given that in the file F1 having 100 records, okay, and same as F2 is having 200 records and so on. We have given all the 6 files F1 to F6. Now in what order should they be stored so as to optimize act? Okay, so here it is talking about the optimization. Assume each file is accessed with the same frequency. Okay, so in this all the 6 files they are be accessed with the same frequency. Okay, so since they all having the same frequency, so we cannot make arrangement with according to the Huffman coding, because in the Huffman code the files which are having the accessing probability or accessing frequency is more, they will get in the short, okay, short code, or they will get in the short path. Okay, but now in this it is directly saying all the files having the same access frequency. So okay, so if we arrange, for example, if I am arranging this like the in this F1, then F2 in the sequential order, F3, F4 and so on, F6. If I am arranging this, so since all are the files having the same frequency, okay, so if let's suppose you we have to access file number F4, okay, so file number F4 will be accessed with the help of this. Okay, so in the file we have this file head pointer. Okay, so now we have to traverse from the starting file or starting location to that location, file number 4. So here we have to cross all these 100, then 200 and then this 50, and then we will get this 80 records. Okay, so we have to cross here all these records, or all these 100, 200 and 50, these many records we have to cross to get the F4. Okay, so in the initials or in the starting, if we store the files which is having the less number of records, then it will be very helpful, or it will be very optimized act to access the files. For example, what are the files which is having the least number of records? So it is file number F3. Okay, and in this file there are only 50 records. So first I will store file number 3, F3. Okay, now in the second number I'll go for the increasing order of the number of records in the file. So then file number 4, F3, then F4, and then I will store this file number F1, then file number F5 in the increasing order of the number of records, file number F5, then F6 and then F2. Okay, so if I store in the files in this order and all the files having the same access frequency, it means all are the equiprobable or equifrequent, means let's suppose if F3 is accessed out of 100, if F3 is accessed let's suppose this is 1 2 3 4 5 6. Okay, so let's suppose there are we accessed one total number of 120 times, and out of this 120 times F3 is accessed 20 times. Okay, and then f1 is also accessed 20 times. So it is the meaning of equifrequent. It means 20 by 120, which is 1 by 6. Okay, so all the files are accessed in this frequency 1 by 6. Okay, 1 by 6th time. So it means, so basically this is example of the equifrequent. Okay, equifrequent files means all the files are having the same access frequency. It means if f3 is accessed 20 times, then f1 is also accessed 20 times out of 120. And this f4 is also 20 times, f2 is also 20 times. So this is the meaning of equal frequency. So in the case of equal frequency, we should go with respect to the increasing number of records of the files. For example, this f3 is having the least number of records, so I am storing here f3 first, then f4, then f1. So if I have to now access file number f5, okay, file number f5, so I will have to start from this start file f3, okay, in the sequential order. So I will have to access only these many, which is in the starting, all are the least number of records files, which are having the least number of records will be accessed. Okay, so only this much, 50 plus 80 plus 100, this much record will be only accessed to get the file number f5. Okay, so this is the answer. Answer is A, means we have to store these files in the increasing order of the number of records in each file. So answer is A here. In this question, we have given a hash table with 10 buckets. Okay, so this is the hash table. In this 10 buckets or 10 cells are present in this hash table. Now with one slot per bucket. So these are the 10 slots here. Now is shown in the following figure. So this is the hash table, and the symbol S1 to S7 initially entered using a hashing function with linear probing. Okay, so what is the meaning of linear probing? Linear probing is the technique of collision resolution. It means if for example two elements the same cell occurred, or the hash function will point or will guide to the same slot for two different keys, then it has to resolve with linear probing. It means it will allocate. Okay, so let's suppose here in this cell, let's suppose 4 is present first, 4 is already present in this cell, and then new key came, and after applying the hash function of that key on that key, it will again saying the index as 2 or slot number 2. So 0 index, 1 index, 2 index. Okay, but since 4 is already present in this cell, so we cannot allocate two keys in the same slot. Okay, so in this scenario, this is called the collision, and for resolving the collision we used here linear probing. So in the linear probing, it will probe for the next available slot, and in the linear fashion. It means it will increment. Okay, so let's suppose this is value coming as 2, so it will increment the value 1. Okay, so it will go here 3, and if 3 is already present here, so it will go again, it will again increment one value, and it will go here because it is linear probing, and in the linear probing each time we have to increment value by 1 and then probe again. Okay, so in this S2 is already present, so again it will go here, and it will see that this slot is empty, so it can accommodate this key into this slot. Okay, so this is the linear probing. So coming back to our question, the maximum number of comparisons needed in searching an item that is not present is. Okay, so we have to find the maximum number of comparisons it get arrived, or what is the condition in which the maximum number of comparisons will be needed. Okay, for let's suppose if we have to search for this key, okay, this is the value key, and we have to search for this key into this hash table. So let's suppose we have one hash function, and after applying this hash function, hash of key, let's suppose this will giving me the value as 8. Okay, so we have to go in the slot which is indexed by 8. Okay, so we will go here. After applying this hash function, we'll go here. Now we see, so here first comparison will occur. We see if this key equals to as 6 or not, or value present at the 8th location or not. So we see that this key is not SX. We are assuming here that key is not the SX, okay, and we are assuming that key is not present inside the table. So it will give the maximum number of comparison, means we have to tell the answer in worst case possible, how many maximum number of comparisons. Okay, so I am assuming here that the required key or the desired key is not present in our hash table. So this is our first comparison, key is equals to SX. Since this comparison fails, we apply linear probing, so it will go here. Again we see that this is not our key, S3 is not our key, so two comparisons occur here. Now again linear probing is applied. So in the linear probing, this 9 plus 1 mod of 10, okay, so 10 mod 10, which means 0. So again we come back here in the linear probing. So now again this key will be compared here, so three comparisons occurred, okay, so key not equals to S7. So again linear probing occur, will go here, and here the fourth comparison will occur. It will check key equals to S1, and since you suppose key is not S1, okay, so four comparisons occurred here, and again we apply the linear probing one by one. So in this linear probing, since this cell is empty, okay, so since this cell is empty, so if this key would have to present in the table, then it would have into this slot, this empty slot only, otherwise this key is not present. So here you'll get to know in this position that since key is not present in this slot, so key will not present in any slot of the table. We'll get to know here at the location number 2, okay. So here we have known that this key is not present inside the table. So till this point we have made four comparisons, and since this is the empty cell, again we have to compare it with the key. So this is the fifth comparison, okay. So totally so maximum number of comparison will occur as 5, okay. So let's suppose in the first time hash key equals to 8, it is giving us 5 comparisons total. But let's suppose hash key in the first time, in the initial, hash key will give 0th position, okay. So if this will be 0th position, then we just compare this once, so one comparison here, then since this is not key, so second comparison here, S1, this is also not key, so third comparison here. So here only 3 comparisons, but we have to find the maximum number of comparisons, okay. So this 0 will be the initials, and then if we consider this S4, okay, in the starting position, let's suppose this key, hash of key, will give me value 3, then we'll go direct here 3, okay. Since this is not key, we'll linear probe here, again the second comparison occurs here, and then again we'll apply linear probing, and now we'll reach here, and since this is empty, so we'll get to know that key is not present inside the whole table. So again here 3 comparisons, so this is also not the maximum, so we'll not take here also. And if this and if let's suppose in the initials hash key will give the value S6, it means this slot, okay. So since this is not key, we'll do linear probing one time, and we'll reach here, and we'll get to know that key is not present in this cell, it means in this slot key is not present. So it the meaning of this will be that key will be not present inside the whole table or whole hash, okay. So that's why, and in this only two comparisons will be occur, so 5 will be the right answer for this question, okay. So 5 is the maximum number of comparisons we can compare, okay, we'll have to compare, so 5 number of times, so maximum will be 5. So this is answer B. In this question, the queue data structure is to be realized by using stack, okay. So we have to implement queue data structures, queue, and we can only use stack here. So we have to implement stack, and we have to implement the queue, and using only the stack data structures. So we have to tell the number of stacks needed would be, so minimum number of, actually number of stacks needed would be, okay. So it cannot be implemented, it is the first option, which is totally wrong, because we can implement the queue using only stacks, okay, let's suppose in the queue there are four elements, one is occurred initially, okay, so it will be pointed by the front, or let's suppose this is the front element of the queue, then 2, then 3 and then 4, and let's suppose this is the rear element. Till now in this scenario this is front and this is rear, so we know that queue is a data structure which follows first in first out, okay, first in first out order, FIFO. So queue is a FIFO data structure. It means whichever element is come first in the queue, it will be popped out, or it will be dequeued first, okay. That's why we have used here two pointers, front and rear. So front will tell us that this one has come first in the list, okay, so this one has come first in the list, so that's why first in first out. So whenever we will have to perform the dequeue operation, or we'll have to delete the element from the queue, one element, so deletion will be happened at the front, okay, this front. That's why it is called the first in first out data structure, because one comes first and it will go out from the queue first, then 2, then 3, then 4, okay. So if we insert any number like 1, 7, 6, 9, so whatever the numbers which are present in the queue, or which we are inserting into the queue, the same order will be come, okay, the same order will be get the same order after applying the dequeue operation. It means always one will be dequeued first, or one will be deleted first, then only 7 will be deleted, and then only 6 will be deleted, and then only 9 will be deleted, okay. But if we are comparing this with the stack, so let's suppose this is the stack, and we are inserting these four elements into the stack also. So okay, so if this is stack number 1, so let's suppose front, okay, so one, let's suppose this one one occurs first, or one comes first, so we'll push into this stack 1. But we know that every operation in the stack will be happen at the top of the stack, okay. So since first in the first position top of the stack will be this, so we'll increment the top of the stack into this position and insert or push, and here in the stack push and pop will be used for inserting and deleting respectively, okay. So for the inserting of one, or for the pushing of one, we'll increment the top of the stack here, TOS, this is top of the stack, and insert or push the one, this one, into the stack. Then 2, so again 2, all the operations can be performed only in the one end, which is at the top of the stack, okay. So 1, 2 and then 3 and then 4. So now at the current position, top will be pointing this fourth element, or this element, okay, element number, which is the value of 4. So now if I am popping the element one by one, then it will give me first 4, because all the operation will be performed at the position top of the stack, at the position which is pointed by top of the stack. So 4 will be comes first, then 3 will be next, then 2 will be next, and then 1 will be next, okay. So this will be our output, but in the case of queue, 1, 2, 3, 4, this will be our output, okay. So these are the two major difference in the queue and stack. It means queue follow the first in first out data structure, and this stack follow the last in first out data structure. What is this last in first out? It means whichever element pushed the last into the stack, which is 4, it is pushed at the last time, okay, last position, and it will come out first, okay. So 4 is the element which has come out or popped out from the stack first, okay. So this is called the LIFO structure. So if we want to implement queue using this stack, so this one complete stack is not sufficient to perform the, or to mimic the operations of queue, which is NQ and DQ, okay. So if we can use two stack, let's suppose this is stack number 2, S2, okay. So and this is stack number 1. So these two we can perform all the queue operations in the same order, as q with the using of this two stacks S1 and S2. So let's suppose we insert first 1, 2, 3, 4. So whenever we insert the element, we'll insert into the stack number 1 first. Okay, so 1, 2, and then 3, and then 4. Okay, so these 4 elements are inserted into the stack. Now, whenever we have to perform the DQ operation of the queue, what will we do? We'll first, if this S1 is not empty, okay, if this S1 is not empty and this S2 is empty, if S2 has some element, then we'll directly pop from this S2. But if this S2 is completely empty, so we have to bring all these elements from S1 to S2 first and then pop from the S2. This is the condition, okay. So since S1 is completely filled, so until the S1 empty, okay, so S1, we have to pop all the elements from the S1 and pushed all these elements into the S2 one by one, and then pop one element from the S2, okay. So first pop this element 4 from this S1 and push into the stack S2. So I'll insert this. So now this cell is empty. Then 3, I'll push here 3, this element is empty. Now 2, I'll push here 2, this element is empty, or this cell is empty. Now 1, so 1 is empty. And now I will have to perform the pop operation from this stack only, okay. So whenever we have to enqueue, or we have to mimic the operation enqueue of the queue, we'll just push inside the S1. And whenever we have to perform the DQ operation of this queue, we'll first have to check if S2 is empty or not. Okay, if S2 is not empty, we'll have to pop one element from here. So this is popping, okay, so 1. So 1 is popped, and then 2 is popped next, and then 3 is popped next, and then 4 is popped next. Okay, so same order here. You can see that the same order of the queue will be maintained here with the help of these two stacks. Okay, so we can say that we can implement this queue data structure with the help of two stack. So our answer will be here, two stacks are required to implement the queue using stacks. So answer is Q. And one more thing, if let's suppose we have to enqueue is easy here. Enqueue is easy, we'll have to just push inside the S1, okay, we'll push inside the S1 stack. But if we have to mimic the operation DQ here, so DQ is a bit tricky. In the DQ operation of the queue, first we'll have to go and see whether S2 is empty or not, okay. If S2 is not empty, it means S2 has some elements, okay. So if S2 has some elements, we'll directly pop those elements from the S2, okay. So whenever we have to perform DQ, we have to pop elements only from the S2 stack, okay, this S2 stack. So whenever this S2 is having some elements, we'll pop the elements from this S2 stack, okay. We'll never touch this S1. But if let's suppose this S1 is having, now this is 432, and let's suppose this one is popped out, okay. So in this S2, 432 is present only, and this is empty, okay. So this is empty, and let's suppose in the S1 we are again pushing some element like 5 and then 6 and then 7 in the S1, okay. Now if I have to DQ, or I have to perform the DQ operation of Q, I'll go first S2 and see if S2 is empty or not, and then we will see that S2 is not empty, S2 has having some elements, so we'll directly pop from this S2. So I'll pop from here, so 2 will be popped, and then 3 will be popped from the stack S2, and then 4 will be popped from the S2. So now this S2 will be completely empty, okay. So now this S2 is empty. Let's suppose this S2 is, I'm drawing here in this S2. So now this S2 is completely empty, okay. Now if we have to perform one more DQ operation, okay. So we'll go in S2 and check whether this S2 is empty or not, and we see that S2 is now completely empty, okay. So if S2 is completely, then we'll have to go to S1 stack and pop all the stack or pop all the elements from the stack S1. It means now we have to empty this stack S1. Okay, so whenever this S2 is empty, we have to go here S1 and pop all the elements from the S1 and push inside the S2. So now I'll pop 7 and push into S2. So this 7, now I'll go here, this is not present now, so now 6, and again I will have to pop this 6 from here and push into this stack S2. So 6, and then 5 from here, I have, now this is empty and again this is empty, so I am popping the 5, element number 5 here, okay, element which is having the value 5. Now I am popping this element and push this element into the top of the stack. Let's suppose this is now top. First top is here, then top here, then top here, and now top is here. Okay, so now 7, 6, 5, this is in the S2, and this is our popped element initially, or before we have popped these elements. Okay, so now again we have to perform one DQ. So now S2 having the elements, so we'll directly go here S2 and pop the elements from here. So then 5 will be popped, and then 6 will be popped, and then 7 will be popped. So in this way, using the two stack, we'll maintain all the operations, or we'll maintain all the orders operations which is performed in the queue. The same, we can mimic the same operation using these two stacks. Okay, so this is the answer of the two stacks. Two stacks is the answer. In this question, consider the following relationship entity diagram, which is ERP. Actually, this is entity relationship diagram. So this is ERD actually. And in this question, we have given this entity relationship diagram. And which of the following possible relations will not hold if the above ERD is mapped into a relational model? So basically, we have to implement the relations, or we have to make the tables for this entity relationship diagram. Okay, corresponding to this ERD. So now what will we do here? Actually, we can see here that this person is one entity and this exam is one entity. Okay, and since this is M to N, okay, so cardinality of this relationship qualification, this qualification is actually the relationship. This will tell the relationship between person and exam. It means one person can have many exams. Okay, so one person can have many qualification exams. Okay, and this one exam can be taken by any person, any number of persons can take this exam. Okay, so basically this is M is to N relationship. Okay, so this is M is to N relationships. So what is the meaning of this relationship? It means, if let's suppose one there are some person, like this is person table. Okay, this is the table which is name as person, and in person table we have two attributes, name and NID. So name of the person and NID will be the key attribute. So let's suppose this is NID and this is name of that person. For example, there are two persons, one two three persons are there, and let's suppose the name of these persons are Raju, Shyam and Ram. Okay, so these are the three persons. Now it is saying that this person Raju can have more than one qualification. Why it person has more than one qualification? Because we can see here that this person can have n number of qualification exams. Okay, so let's suppose this Raju has qualified in the GATE examination, and then this Raju is also qualified in the NET examination, and also some PhD. This Raju has done some PhD also, and this Shyam, let's suppose this Shyam having only one. It need not be that each person has to qualify n number of examination. Okay, M is to N means it can have more than one, or one also. So let's suppose Shyam has qualified only the GATE examination, and this person Ram has qualified GATE and let's suppose some exam like IES and IES also, UPSC IES. Okay, so this Ram has also qualified these three examination. Okay, so this is the scenario of this person table. Now it is clearly seen that we cannot add one attribute of exam ID. Let's suppose this gate net PhD gate, this is the exam ID. So we cannot take here the exam ID. Why we cannot take exam ID attribute here directly? Because if we will take the exam ID attribute, which is saying the relationship qualification between person and exam. So if we will take this exam ID as one attribute here, so we'll have to consider the multi attribute. Okay, so we'll have to consider this exam ID as a multi value attribute. Why multi value attribute? Because one person can have many number of examination qualification. Okay, one person can have many qualifications. So that's why we cannot take here exam ID as a attribute. So we cannot take, so one table will be final only this person, name, NID and name. Okay, we cannot take exam ID here. Now let's suppose this exam, in this exam table, this is exam table. Okay, so in this exam table, this is exam ID, EID I am putting here, EID and ename. Okay, so let's suppose exam ID is for gate is gate, this is one exam ID, and exam name is graduate aptitude test in engineering, so on. Okay, so this is the full name, and next exam is UGC NAT, so I'm putting here NAT is the exam ID, and the exam name is here national eligibility test, so on. Okay, so this is name, and again I'm putting here IES exam, and IES exam as exam ID, and putting the E name as Indian Engineering Services. Now again putting here IES exam, and value is name of the this exam is Indian Administrative Services. Okay, so let's suppose these are the exam table, this is the exam table, and this exam table contains these many values. Now this is exam ID, this is exam name, these two attributes are covered. Okay, but since this exam has a relationship with person, so let's suppose I am taking here person ID to keep track of this relationship qualification. So for example, I am taking this person ID here. So now in this person ID, okay, so I have to keep track all the person's ID, all the person's ID which have qualified the gate examination. So here we know that this Raju, Shyam and Ram, all of these three persons have qualified in the gate examination. So I have to put the person's ID for Raju, for Ram, for this Ram and for this Shyam also. Okay, so I have to put this 1, 2, 3 here. Now I will have to put the person's ID which the persons who have qualified the NET examination. So what are the persons? Only this Raju. Okay, Raju has qualified NET, so I am putting here only one. Now IES is qualified by 3, this person ID 3, and this IAS is qualified also person ID 3. So now you can see clearly that if I am taking person ID as attribute in the exam table for having or for keep track the this relationship qualification, so this person ID attribute will have in some case multiple values. Okay, and in the database and in the relations or in the table, in the relational database model, we cannot allow any attribute having the multiple values. Okay, so this person ID will not be taken here. Why? Because if we are taking person ID, then this attribute will become a multi-value attribute, and we cannot allow the multi-value attribute in this table and in any table in the relational database model. So we cannot take PID here. Okay, so definitely this table, which is in the option C, exam ID, person ID which is NID and exam name. So we cannot take any such table, we cannot make any such table in the RDBMS. So in the question they are saying which of the following possible relations will not hold if the above ERD is mapped into a relational table. So definitely this will be not our answer, because we have seen clearly here we cannot take this as okay person ID or name ID here, so we cannot take here. So this is the right option, means we cannot make this table. Okay, so this is right, this is our answer actually. But now we are considering little more. So person NID name, okay, so this table we can make, so this is fine, this table is fine. Now qualification NID, exam ID, qualified ID. Okay, since we cannot take here exam ID in this percent table, and we should not take the PID or person ID in this exam table also. So now if we have to keep track the relationship with person and the qualification or with the exam, so what will we do? We will make one separate relation or one separate table for this qualification relationship. Okay, for this relationship we'll have to make one separate table, and in this separate table we'll take candidate key, or we'll take the primary key from this table, so which is NID. So I will take NID here, and then I will take exam ID here, which is I am putting EID here. Okay, and one more thing, because in the qualification relationship we have one attribute, it is qualified date, so I will take one Q date attribute also here. So now this table will be fine. Okay, and this table is needed to keep track the relationship between person and exam. So in this we can take any number of time NID. This is NID, is NID and EID, both will make the primary key for this table or candidate key for this table. Okay, so here the composite, these two attribute composite key will be make. Okay, now let's suppose this NID 1, which is name Raju, he has qualified 3 examination. Okay, GATE, NET and PhD. So I will have to write here GATE corresponding to 1, and then corresponding to 1 I have to write NET examination, and also corresponding to 1 I have to put PhD examination here also. So in this way we will have to make table NID, exam ID and then the qualification date or qualified date. So in this table we will not use the multi value attribute. Okay, so this is also fine, this table will be needed here. And the last one is exam ID, exam name. Okay, so this table is also needed here. So only table which we cannot make this table according to the RDBMS rule or relational database rule. So answer is here C. So in this question, consider the following log sequence of two transactions on a bank account with initial balance is 12,000. Okay, so there are two transactions T1 and D2, and they both are using the same bank account. Okay, same bank account with in these two different transactions, and the initial balance in the bank account is 12,000, and this 12,000 from this account it will transfer 2,000 to a mortgage payment. Okay, so 2,000 is giving or 2000 is paid as a mortgage payment, and then apply a 5% interest in that savings account or in the balance of that account. Okay, so suppose the database system crashes just before log record 7 is written. So this statement is done, then this statement is basically, it is starting the T1 transaction, then T1 B old equals to 12,000. This is actually 12,000. Okay, so in this, if let's suppose this is the variable B which is containing the balance of the account, so in the starting this will be 12,000. Okay, now in this T1 transaction we are paying 2,000 from this account, so B old value will be 12,000 and B new will be 10,000. Why? Because we are giving 2,000 from this account as a mortgage payment, so now it is having 10,000. Now in the T1 transaction M old equals to 0, it means we have one mortgage. Okay, mortgage variable, so previous value of mortgage is 0, and after subtracting 2,000 from here, this 2,000 should be added in this mortgage payment. Okay, so now new value will be 2,000. This is new and this is old value of both these balance and mortgage payment. Now T1 commit. Okay, so T1 commit, what it meant by after performing these two operations, these two actions will be committed. Committed means these two are finalized, these two values are finalized, and this is written into the database. Okay, so now these two values will have been written in the database. So database log is one there. Okay, so in the database this value of this is updated. Okay, permanently. So now this is B's value will be 10,000 and M value will be 2,000 in our database log, and it is saved. Now T1 commit, okay, this has happened. Now T2 start. Again, one new transaction T2 will be start, and T2 be old equals to 10,000. So you can assume, or you can clearly experience this, that why we are starting this T2 transaction, because now we have to perform this operation, apply a 5% interest on the savings account or in the balance, okay. So that's why we have started this T2 transaction, and the old value of T2 in the B, which is 10,000, we have to apply 5% interest, so new value will be now 10,500 here, okay. And in the seventh line, we have to commit this T2 also. But in the question they have given, this database system crashes just before log record 7 is written. So before this log record 7, this database system is crashes in this point. Okay. So after updating the value in the local cache of database 10,500, which is not done in the permanent DBMS system, this our database system now here crashes. Okay. So now if this database system is crashes, so when the system is restarted, and let's suppose after some time we are restarting the system, so which one statement is true of the recovery procedure? So we will have to identify what is the recovery procedure, or what will be the true recovery procedure in this case. Okay, so in this case, actually in this complete log record, we are not using anywhere the checkpoint term. Okay. So we are not using the term as checkpoint. So let's suppose this is here the checkpoint is used. Okay. So since checkpoint is not used after this commit, so we will have to redo all the transactions which are committed, or all the operations of the committed transactions, okay, because checkpointing is not used here. If assume after this commit statement, if let's suppose here checkpoint term is also used as checkpointed has done here, so we'll not have to do now the again these operations. But since this is commit statement and all these are permanently saved in DBMS, but we have not checked it out, okay, checkpointed, we have not used this checkpoint after this commit. So if the system again restarted, we'll have to redo all these things. And in the uncommitted transaction, since this is uncommitted transaction till this point, so all the write operations, or all the modified, or all the updation operation of the undo, so we have to actually undo all the write operations of the uncommitted, or this is also called the active transactions, okay. So all the write operations of the uncommitted transactions, which is T2, we have to undo all the operations using the undo procedure, okay. So now this option is right, okay, and the operation should be undone in the reverse order of the order in which they were written into the log, okay. So if they were log like this, new is 10,500 and old is this, so we have to first undo this statement, and then undo this statement, and undo this statement, okay, and redo all the with respect to the uncommitted or active transaction. But this will be with respect to the committed transaction, we have to redo all the write operations, okay, redo all the write operations of the committed transactions from the log in the order in which they were written into the log. So first again we'll have to do this statement, and then this statement, and then this statement, and then this statement, and then commit, okay. So we have to redo these operations from here to here, and undo in the reverse order from here to here. So in this T2 we have to do undo, and for T1 transaction we have to redo. So what will be the answer? We must undo log record 6 to set B to 10,000, and then redo log records 2 and 3. So this is the right answer, B here. In this question, given a block, okay, so we have given one database block. So let's suppose this is one block, and this block can hold either 3 records or 10 key pointers, okay. So 10 key pointers So it can store either three records, okay? So this complete block can store either three records, okay, in one block, three records in one block. I am writing like this, three records in one block, or 10 key pointers, okay? So, or also it can store 10 key plus pointer pair which are used in the database, 10 key pointer pairs in one block. So it can store like this. Now a database contains n records, okay? So in the database system, let's suppose this is the database system, this is database, and it is containing the n records, 1, 0, 1, 2, like n minus 1. So there are totally n records in the database. Then how many blocks do we need to hold the data file and the dense index, okay? So we have to tell how many blocks. So blocks, actually the answer will be blocks required to store, block required to store this data file, this complete data file which is having n records, this plus the index, dense index, okay, plus blocks required in dense index. So this will be our answer. So now we'll have to find the number of blocks required to store the data file. Since this is in this data file there are n records, okay, and here three records can be stored in one block, so n records can be stored in n divided by 3 number of blocks, okay? So here it will use n by 3 blocks to store the data file, plus again this is same. Now we are using the dense indexing. Dense indexing means for every record, for each record in the data file, we will provide one entry to the index also. For each record we will provide one entry to the index, into the index, okay? So basically we have to store n key plus pointer pair in the index file also, okay? So 10 key plus pointer pair can store in one block, so we'll have to take n key plus pointer pairs. So it will take how many, let's suppose this is n key plus pointer pair, so how many it will take, n by 10, this is number of blocks it will take to store the dense index. So n by 3 plus n by 10, so our final answer will be, this is 30, and if we solve this, this will be 13 n by 30. So this is our final answer. So answer is this. In this question, the maximum length of an attribute of type text is, okay, so we have to find the maximum length of an attribute of type text. So let's suppose this is text, okay, and this text is having one attribute, okay? Let's suppose this is one attribute, so we have to tell the maximum length of this attribute, okay? This attribute will have anything like this, this is either file name, this is size, and something like this. So it is, let's suppose this is one text, type text, and it is having one attribute, so we have to tell what is the maximum length of this attribute. So since this is variable actually, so attribute of type text we can define any size. For example, 256 length, 255 length, 127 length, it will be depend on the user, or it will be depend on the programmer, so that it can define any size variable in the attribute, okay? So maximum length of an attribute of type text is, it is actually variable. So right answer is D here. In this question, let R equals to A, B, C, D, E, F be a relation, okay, relation scheme actually. So this is relation scheme R, and in this there are attributes of A, B, C, D, then E, and then F. So these are the attributes here, and this is relation scheme R. So this is relation scheme R, and these are the attributes with the following dependencies, okay? So there we have also given some dependencies. For example, this is C to F, and then E to A, and then EC. This EC composite, these two will derive the D, okay, and this A to B. So what is the meaning of this dependencies here? Dependencies means with the help of C, or with seeing only just value of C, we can uniquely derive all the values of F, okay? So this is the meaning of dependencies. e to a, it means with the help of a e or with the value of e, we can uniquely define or we can uniquely derive the value of a. Here, with the help of e and c value of e and c, compositely, we can derive the value of d uniquely. And from a to b, with the help of this value of a attribute, we can uniquely identify or we can uniquely derive the value of b. Okay, so this is basically the dependencies. Now we have to find the key of this R. So we have to find key. So what is the key? Key actually, let's suppose this is one table. Let's suppose this is one table. In this table, we have three attributes A, B, C. This is different. This is different table S. Okay. So now, if this I am giving the dependency here randomly, like A to B and B to C. Okay. So in this table, with the help of A, or it means we can see the value of A, we can derive. So we can take this star closure. It means with the help of seeing only the value of A, what are the values of what are the attributes we can derive uniquely. So A plus it will give A, and then since we can go A to B, so I will put here in the closure AB also, and from B to C, so I'll put C also in the closure of A. So with the help of A, or by just seeing the value of A, we can derive all the value of A, B, C uniquely. So since if some attribute or the set of attribute can derive all the remaining attributes of the table, so this thing is called the key. So here A is the key of this table. So this is key. So in this table of R, we have to find the key of this R. So first we have to derive all the attributes here. So we can derive F because F is right hand side. A, we can derive A from some attribute from this E. We can derive also D. We can derive B. And these are the total attributes A, B, C, D, E and F. So what are the attributes we can derive with the help of dependency? F we can derive. A we can derive. A also. D also we can derive. And B also we can derive. But you can see that with the help of any dependency, we cannot derive C uniquely and also E uniquely. So we cannot derive E and C with the help of any dependency. So we must take C and E as a key. Okay, because key has to derive all the attributes uniquely. So C E we must have to take here. Now I'll find out the C E closure, because we must have to take C E. And now if this C compositely can derive all the remaining attribute as well as C and E, so this will become our key. Okay, so let's suppose this is C plus, it means I have to find the closure here. So from C I can find F, and first of all from C E closure it will contain C E also, because C to C we can derive and E to E. Every time this is C to C and E to E, this is actually the trivial dependencies. These are always followed. Okay, now we have to find the non-trivial ones. So F, C, E, and then from E to A we can derive A uniquely here. Now from this E and C, these two combinedly will derive the D, and from A, this A, we can derive B. So you can see here we can completely derive all the attributes A, B, C, D, E and F. So our key will be here CE, because CE we must take CE in our key, and this CE is able to derive all the remaining attributes ABCDEF, all the attributes it can derive. So it is key. Now since this is C, if now we want to add some more attribute, we want to find more keys here. So if I'll add some attribute like A here in this, so it is also, it can also derive all the thing uniquely, but this will not be our key. This is our super key. Why? Every superset of the key, this is key, every superset of the key will be the super key. It is not the candidate key, and we have to find the key only here. So key will be EC. EC is the right answer here. In this question, these are, if D1, D2, Dn, these are the domains in a relational model. So what is the meaning of domain here? Let's suppose this is one relation name as student. Okay,
So this is student relation, and in this student relation, let's suppose one there is roll number. Okay, roll number is one attribute of this student. Okay, now roll number and student name, S name and class. Okay, so these three are the attributes of this student table or student relation. So what is the meaning of this domains here? So domain means this will be one domain, means D1, because it belongs to one special domain called the integer, because all the roll number we define as all the roll number should be integer only. So that's why this particular attribute is called one domain. Okay, so this is one domain D1, this whole thing is one another domain D2, which belongs a string or character, a set of characters. Okay, and class is also one integer, so this is one domain. So these three are the domain of this relation. So we have to tell which is a subset of. Okay, so we have to tell if D1, D2, Dn are domains in a relational model, then the relation is a table. Okay, this is one relation and this is one table, which is a, so this table, okay, this table is a subset of. So this table is a subset of which of the following. Okay, so if this D1, this is actually D1, this is symmetric difference D2, symmetric difference D3, Dn. So this is not our right answer. It means our relation is not the subset of this one. But yeah, cross product, if I do the cross product of each domains here, D1, D2, D3, Dn, if I am doing the cross product here, so it will give me complete all set of combination or all possible combination. For example, let's suppose there are three students, 1, 2, 3, and name is there A, B, C, and class is 6, 7, 8. Then this D1 cross D2 cross D3, this is D1, this is D2, and this is D3. It will, if I am doing the cross product here, it will give me like this, 1A6. This I'm doing this row with all those this two column. Okay, cross product with these two. So 1A6, then 1A7, then 1A8. Okay, now 1A. Sorry, yeah. Now 1A6, 1A7, 1A8. Now 1B6. If I'm taking this now 6 here, so 1B6, then 1B7, then 1B8. Okay, like this. So all are the possible combination will be present here. But our table is the subset of these possible combination. All the possible combination. Our table is a strict or proper subset of this. So our answer will be here, D1 cross D2 cross Dn. So the relation or a table is the subset of this cross product of all the domains here. In this question, we have given this query and we have to tell what is the output of this query. So for solving this question, let's suppose we have three tables, which is supplier S, and there is one more table, catalog and parts. So I am making three tables and I am putting some values, some random values in these three tables. So let's suppose this is supplier table. Okay, this is supplier table. In this supplier table, I can identify the attributes from the given query. For example, this supplier has SID and name. So I am putting here SID, which is supplier ID, and name of that supplier. So I am putting some random value like S1, name is Ram, S2 Shyam, then S3 there is Raju, and for S4 supplier ID S4 name is Rohit, and supplier ID S5 Krishna, and let's suppose there is S6 and name is Mohan. Okay, so now this is supplier table. I have one more table, which is catalog. In catalog table, I can identify the catalog table here. See, from catalog, one is supplier ID and one is part ID. So I'm putting here one is supplier ID, so SID, and one is parts ID, PID. Okay, so this catalog contains the list of the suppliers and also the suppliers who supplied the parts. Okay, for example, this supplier ID S1, this supplier ID S1 has supplied the part ID 1, S2 supplied the part ID 1, and again S3 supplied the part ID 3, S2 again supplied part ID 5. So S2 here supplied 1 and 5, and again S1 supplied 2. Okay, so this. And let's suppose there are two more supplier, S4 and S5, and S4 supplied part ID 4 and S5 supplied part ID 6. Okay, so this is actually 6. Now this is catalog table, and we have one more table which is parts table. Okay, parts P, and in the query P ID and P color are the two attribute of this part table. So P ID and color. Okay, so PID and color here. So let's suppose the part ID 1 has color blue. Why I am taking blue here explicitly? Because it is actually the complete query is not equal to, this is not equal to sign, and here blue. Okay, so this is actually the complete query. Okay, so where P dot color not equals to blue. So I am taking one part as blue, and another second part is also, let's suppose, color blue. Third part is red. Third part's color is red. Fourth part color is orange. This is orange. And the fifth part color is green. And the sixth part color is white. Let's suppose this is the this is tables. Okay, for all the three, supplier, catalog, and parts. Now we can run the query. Okay, so this is actually the inner query. Okay, in this query there are two inner query, and we know that first the innermost query will be run and output will be, or result will be generated by the innermost query. So what is the innermost query here? This is one outer query, and inside this query there is this query, and inside this query there is this inner query. Okay, so this is the inner query of this. So select C dot SID from catalog C. So catalog C we have to select from this table, where C dot PID not in. So those SID we have to take which PID not in. So not in. Okay, so for not in we have to solve this query. So select P dot PID from parts B, where P dot color not equals to blue. Okay, so let's suppose I am giving the name, this query is 3, this query is 2, and the outermost query is 1. Okay, so first I am solving the innermost query, or query number 3. So output of the innermost query 3 will be, this will generated as, we have to select PID where P dot color not equals to blue. So this will be not selected, this will be not selected, because here color is blue. These four parts will be selected. So in the, let's suppose this is ABC, this is C, query number C, this is query number B, and this is query number A. Okay, so now result of query number C will produce two is blue and one is blue. So this will be not selected. Apart from these two, all PID will be selected. So what are the PID will be selected? 3, 4, and then 5, and then 6. So these PID will be selected of this query. Now again we are solving the query number B. So in the query number B it is saying we have to select C dot SID, means from this table, catalog table, we have to select supplier ID SID where C dot PID, it means the part ID is not present in this set, in this complete set. Which are the parts ID not present in this complete set? Then corresponding to those parts ID we have to select the SID. Okay, so not in. Okay, so not in this set. So this 3, this complete will be not selected. Why? Because 3 is present here and we have to select not in. And again 5 is not selected, this 3 is not selected, and 1 and 2 will be selected. So this part ID 1 2 will be selected, and this 4 and 6 already present here, 4 and 6, so we cannot select these two also. Okay, so what is the query, what is the result of this query number B? It will give the supplier ID S1 S2, and this is again S1. Okay, so it will give supplier ID as S1 and S2. This is the result of query number B, so which is select C dot SID. Okay, so we have selected this SID where PID not in this. Now we have to perform this select S dot name from suppliers S where s dot sid not in. Okay, so we have to select now supplier id from this supplier table, where the supplier id sid will should not be in this set. Okay, so s1 and s2 we should not take this one because not in. Now we have to take, so query number query a will result s3, s4, s5, s6. So s3, s4, s5, this is s5 and this is s6. So query number a or the outermost query or the final answer will be supplier name of this sid. Okay, so what will it represent? S3 means Raju, S4 means Rohit, Krishna and Mohan. So all these four will be selected as a final result. Okay, so if we match, you can see that supplier id S3, S4, S5 and S6, this S3, S5 they have not supplied any parts which is having the color blue. Why? Because you can see that S1 and S2 has supplied the parts which is having color blue. For example, S1 has supplied part number 1 and part number 2. Okay, and part number 1 and 2 has color blue. So we are not selecting S1 here. And again, S2 has supplied part number 1 and part number 5. Okay, since 5's color is green, but S2 has supplied 1 also, part number 1 also, and color of this part number 1 is blue. So in this query, actually this query results the name of those suppliers who have not supplied any blue part. Okay, who have not supplied any blue part, because S3 has not supplied any blue part, S4 has also not supplied any blue, S5 has also not supplied any blue part, and S6 has also not supplied any blue part. So we have to match the option. So first option is find the names of all suppliers who have supplied non-blue part. Actually, in this query, find the names of all suppliers who have supplied non-blue part. Okay. So S3 has supplied non-blue part, S4 has supplied non-blue, S5 has supplied non-blue, and S6 has supplied non-blue. Okay, this is true. But let's suppose there is one S7 also. There is one S7 supplier also. And name of S7, let's suppose something like XYZ. Okay, so name of S7 is XYZ. And S7 is not present in this table. It means S7 supplier has not supplied any parts. Whether it is blue or non-blue, it has not supplied any kind of part. And in that case, also we have to select S7. Okay, in that case, we have to select S7. Why? Because query is saying s.sid not in this set. Okay. Not in this set. So S7 also will be selected in this query. Okay. But S7 has not supplied any blue any parts. Okay. So this query will be going wrong, which is saying find the names of all suppliers who have supplied non-blue part. This is wrong because S7 is also selected and S7 has not supplied anything, any part. Okay. So this is not the right answer. Find the names of all suppliers who have not supplied non-blue part. Who have not supplied non-blue part means who have supplied blue parts. So here S1 and S2 supplied blue parts, but query is not resulting that. So it is completely wrong. Now the third statement is find the names of all suppliers who have supplied only non-blue parts. Only non-blue parts, it means we have, this is actually, I think these two are same, A and C. Find the names of all suppliers who have supplied non-blue parts. And find the names of suppliers who have supplied only. Okay, here it is saying only non-blue parts, but it is also not right. Okay, so this is also not right. The third option is find the names of all suppliers who have not supplied only non-blue part. It is also not right. So our answer is actually this query will result the name of the suppliers who has actually supplied only blue part, who has not supplied any blue part. Sorry, who has not supplied. Not supplied. This is actually supplied any blue parts. Okay, so any blue parts. So this is the right answer for this query. Who has not supplied any blue parts? We have to select those S name or those suppliers name who has not supplied any blue part. So this is the right answer. In this question, consider the following schema: employee a simple SQL query is executed as follows. Okay, so in this question we have given one employee table. This is employee table. Let's suppose this is employee, and we have here employee code. Okay, employee code, name, sex, salary, and department. So these are the five attributes we have given in the employee table, and we have to identify the output of the following SQL query. So first we should know the order of the execution of SQL query. In any SQL query, this SQL query will follow one order, from F, J, W, G, H, S, D, O. Okay, so you can remember this order. So what is this F? F means from, then join will occur, J means join, then where condition or where clause will be executed next, and then group by executed next, then having executed next, and then this S is select. Okay, so this select will be occur after these, all these, from, join, where, group by, having, select, and this distinct, this is D is distinct, and this is order by. O means order by. Okay, so in this query, what clause will be executed first? So it will execute from first. Okay, so from means employee. So we are now in this employee table, and second one will be join. So we have to check if there is any join in the given query. No, there is not any join. So after join, we have to perform or we have to execute where clause. So from this employee table, where sex equals to male, M means male. So now where condition will execute it, and we have selected all the rows all the employees in which the sex equals to male. So now the sex is male, all the male employees is now selected, and then after this where executed, we have to execute group by clause. Okay, so now group by department. So all the male employees we have to now make the group for those male employees. We have to make group according to their department. For example, there is department number, let's suppose there is some one department which is education department. So in the education department, all the male employees will be form one group. Okay, so all the male employee in the education department, male. Okay, so these are other attribute. This is one attribute. So in the education department, all these will be together. And then let's suppose there is one IT department in one company. So IT department, all the male employees will be there in one group. So male. And let's suppose there is one more department, which is randomly HR department. So one HR department is also there in the company, and all the male employees will be form one group together. So this is now structure. And after this group by, we have to execute the having condition or having clause. Okay, so in the having clause, they are saying average salary is, this average is actually a function. Okay, this is actually a function, average. Okay, so average salary. So we will have to calculate, or we'll have to execute the average salary, means all the salary. Okay, in this is salary attribute, so it will calculate the average salary. So now having average salary is greater than select average salary from employee. Okay, so this having average salary, it will execute in the particular group. For all group, average salary will be calculated. This is average salary for this education group, and this is average salary for this IT group or IT department. Average salary for IT department, this is average salary for the HR department. So having average salary means we have calculated now all departments average salary. Okay, respectively, this is the average salary of this is average salary of this department, this is average salary of this department. Now this average salary should be greater than select average salary from employee. So this query is the inner query, and the result of this query will be fetched once. Okay, so let's suppose the inner this inner query result around 15,000. Let's suppose this is 15,000. So select average salary from employee, So all the employees, if we calculate the average salary for all this employee table, so it will give me value around 15,000. Okay, now let's suppose this education department has the average salary as 20,000. Okay, this is having 20,000. This IT department is having the salary, let's suppose average salary is around 50,000 for the IT department, and this HR department average salary is around, let's suppose, 10,000. Okay, so now our query will select having average salary greater than all the average salary from all the employee. Okay, so what departments will be selected now? So this department, since this 20,000 is greater than this departments will be selected, then this IT department will be selected, but this department, complete department, will be not selected. Okay, so now this education and IT, we have two departments, and in those two departments only the male employees will be there for calculation of this. Okay, so now we have performed having, now we have to select S, or this is S, order S. So now we have to select this condition. So what we have to select department from employee. So we have to select only department. It means education department will be selected, IT department, only the department name will be selected. Okay, so finally the answer is here. So output will be average salary of male employee is more than the average salary of the organization. Average salary of male employee. So in the output, it will select the department in which average salary of male employee is more than the average salary of the organization. This is the right answer. Okay, so this is right, D option. So in this question, given the following expression grammar, this is the expression grammar we have given, which of the following is true? Okay, so we know that in the expression grammar, the symbols or the operator which are having in the lower order, for example, this is E, and E to E star F means multiplication, or F plus E or F. Okay, so this is, and from F it is going F minus F or ID. So in this you can see that this minus operator, this minus symbol is in the lower order of this star and plus. This is order or level number 1, this is level number 2. So this is in the lower level, this minus is in the lower level. So whenever any operator in the lower level that is having the higher precedence than the operator which is having the higher level, which is in the higher level. For example, here this minus operator is having higher precedence than star or plus. Okay, so minus has higher precedence than star, this is true statement. And in the same level, if this is in the same level, star and plus in the same level number 1, so in this they have same precedence, star and plus having the same precedence. And for the associativity, we have to see the recursion. For example, this E to E star F, it is the left recursive grammar, E star F. So this star's associativity is left to right, means first in the order, if there are more than one star will be in the statement, then first left hand side star will be evaluated, and then the right hand side. Okay, so left to right we have to evaluate the star, and for plus there is associativity, or there is right recursive, E to F plus E. So this is right recursion, so plus will be evaluated from right to left. And for minus or for this operator, associativity is not defined, because F to F minus F, here also F and here also F, so it is not the left recursive as well as not the right recursive. So for this operator minus, there is no associativity defined. So our answer is minus has higher precedence than star. This is the answer. In this question, the number of tokens in the following C statements is. So we have to count the token here. So token is basically the number, the group of character which is having the meaning in one programming language. For example, here this printf, it is a sequence of characters. This complete is a sequence of character, and this printf has the predefined meaning in the C language or C library. Okay, so this will be one token. This parenthesis is single token. So one, this is one, this is two. Now from here, this every string, okay, from here to here, this is complete one token. So this is token number 3, this comma is token number 4, this I is token number 5, this comma is again token number 6, this is 7, this is 8, this is 9, and this is 10. So answer is 10 here. So in this question, which grammar rules violates the requirement of the operator grammar? A, B, C are variables, and A, B, C, small a, these are the terminals. So for the grammar having the operator grammar, there will be two conditions. If grammar should follow these two conditions, then that grammar will be a operator precedence or operator grammar. So the condition, first condition is, in the right hand side of any production, no two variables or no two non-terminals will occur consecutively. It means, for this example, this A to BC, this is violating the rule of operator grammar. Why? Because B is also non-terminal and C is also non-terminal, and these two non-terminals are occurring together consecutively. But if it will occur like this, A, B, A, C. So here this B and C is separated by one terminal value, one operator. This will be one operator here. So B, A, C, this is now terminal. So B, A, C. So this will allow in the operator grammar. Okay. So this is one condition. So it is violating this rule. Okay. So this will be answer our. And also in the operator grammar, there should not be any null production. For example, this A to epsilon, this should be not present in the operator grammar. This is rule number 2 or condition number 2. So this is also violating the requirement of operator grammar, this rule. So both A and D are the right answer. But in the question, this is actually the single correct choice question. So in this question, marks have given to all the students who have appeared in this ISRO 2015 examination. So answer is A and D here, both are violating the rule of operator grammar. In this question, which one of the following is a top down parser? So we have to tell which is top down parser. Recursive descent parser, yes, it is the top down parser. Shift left associative parser, it is not the top down parser. SLR parser is the bottom up parser, so it is not top down. And also LRK parser, for example LR1X parser is also bottom up parser, so it is not right. So the only top down parser here is recursive descent parser. YACC stands for, okay, so this YACC actually it is the full form of, it is the short form of this yet another compiler. So this is basically a program, a computer program, YACC, a computer program for the Unix OS. So it can run in the Unix operating system, and it is a LALR, basically it is a LALR parser generator, and which is LALR parser, look ahead, left to right, okay. So yet another compiler is a YACC, and it is a computer program. In this question, which statement is true? So first statement is LALR parser is more powerful and costly as compared to other parser. So this statement is wrong, because the most powerful and costly order is this. It is the increasing order of powerfulness and cost. Okay, so LR0 is least powerful and least cost. Okay, then SLR1, this is also one parser, SLR1, which is having the higher power from with LR0. And then there is LALR, okay, so LALR1 or LALR, and then there is CLR1. So in this statement, this is wrong. LALR parser is more powerful. It is not more powerful and costly as compared to other. Actually, this CLR1, canonical LR, left to right, this parser, it is bottom up parser, and this parser is the most powerful parsers among these four, and also this is most costly parser. So this statement is not right. The second one is, all context free grammars are LP and not all grammars are uniquely defined. So actually this LP is the linear precedence. This is a rule in the compiler design, linear precedence rule. Okay, so what is linear precedence rule? We can see here, and also the grammar generated by this linear precedence rule. Whenever we generate any grammar which is following the linear precedence rule, they are always the context free. They are always context free grammar. So linear precedence rules generate always the context free grammar. But it is not saying, it is actually like this. If this is linear precedence, okay, so if there are, this grammar is generated by linear precedence, then all the linear precedence grammars generated by the linear precedence are always the context free grammar. Okay, so this is valid. It means all the grammars which is generated by linear precedence rules are always context free grammar. But it is not true that all the context free grammars are LP also, because there are some other grammars which are not generated by linear precedence rules, but they are also the context-free grammars. So in this, it is saying all context-free grammars are LP and not all grammars are uniquely defined. So this is the wrong answer. This is not right. The third one is every SLR grammar is unambiguous, but not every unambiguous grammar is SLR one. Okay, so SLR. So we have written this four parsers. And they all the four parsers can only generate the unambiguous, means these parsers can be used only when grammar is unambiguous. Okay, so here grammar should be unambiguous. So for SLR also the grammar is unambiguous. So it is saying every SLR grammar is unambiguous. It is right, but not every unambiguous grammar is SLR. So this statement is right actually. Okay, and this statement is right. Every SLR grammar is unambiguous, but not every unambiguous grammar is SLR. So it is not true that if there is unambiguous grammar, then always it is SLR. Why? It can be LLR grammar. It can be SLR grammar, because all these four grammars are four parsers are unambiguous. So every SLR grammar is unambiguous, but not every unambiguous grammar is SLR. This statement is true. The last one is LRK. This is LRK is the most general backtracking shift reduce parsing method. So this statement is right. This statement is wrong actually. Here all the things are right except this. LRK is the most general. This is non backtracking. This backtracking it is not allowed in the LR parsers. Backtracking is not allowed here. So it is the most general non backtracking shift reduce parsing method. It is also shift reduce parsing method, but it is non backtracking shift reduce parsing method. So this statement is again false. So answer is C here. So in this question, semaphores are used to solve the problem of. So what is semaphore? Semaphores are the variables, okay, and there are two types of semaphores, and it can take only the integer values. There are two types of semaphores. One is binary semaphores, which is called as mutex, these are using for the mutual exclusion, binary semaphore. And binary semaphore having the value only either 0 or 1. Okay, so this is the binary semaphore. It is also called mutex. Why it is called mutex? Because it is used for the mutual exclusion problem or mutual exclusion purpose. And the second type of the semaphore is the counting semaphore. It can take any value, any integer value inside the counting semaphore. So actually the semaphores are used to solve the problem of. They are used to solve the problem of. First we should see what is the race condition here. So race condition means if there is one part of the code, let's suppose this is one part of the code, and in this there are some shared resources or shared variable used in this code. Okay, so shared resources is used in this code. Now if there are more than one process, for example this is P1, this is P2 and this is P3, so more than one process, if they are trying to access this code or if they are running this or executing this code, then sometimes the final outcome will be depend on the order of the execution of process. It means if P1 execute this code first, then P2, then P3, then result is something like A. And when if this P2 executing first, then P1 and P3, then the result will be B. Okay, so in this code there will be inconsistency if there is some processes which are not synchronized, and they are using simultaneously these code, simultaneously this shared code, okay. So this is called the race condition. Race condition means the final outcome or final result of the of this code will be depend on the order of the execution of process, okay. This is order changing, the order and also values changing. So this is called the race condition. So for race condition, this for solving this problem, okay, we use the synchronization method. What is synchronization method? Process synchronization is actually the method if there are some shared resources and more than one process are trying to access those shared resources, then there is some methodology of the synchronization. For example, lock and some mutex and some counting semaphores. So there are some these kind of methodology which can by which we can solve this problem, okay, problem race condition through the process synchronization method. So actually the process synchronization, for the purpose of this process synchronization, we used the semaphores, okay. So binary semaphores are used in the process synchronization and also in the mutual exclusion. What is mutual exclusion? Mutual exclusion means if there is some shared variable, let's suppose this is shared variable A. This A is shared between any number of process, P1, P2, let's suppose P3. Now, this shared variable can be accessed simultaneously, okay, by these process. But this will create inconsistency in the outcome of this system or outcome of or result of the system, okay. So we have to provide mutual exclusion here. What is mutual exclusion? Mutual exclusion means if this P1 process is executing this code or using this shared variable or accessing this shared variable, then no other process P2, P3 and so on, PN, no other process can be simultaneously access this shared variable. This is called the mutex or mutual exclusion. It means at one point of the time only one process is accessing this code. So this mutual exclusion this problem can be solved with the help of binary semaphore, which is also called mutex. So mutual exclusion can be solved by binary semaphore and process synchronization is also solved by the semaphores. So answer is 2 and 3 here. So this is the right answer, 2 and 3. In this question, if there are 32 segments, okay, 32 segment and each size 1 kilobytes, then the logical address should have. So there are totally 32 segments in the logical address space, 32 segments, okay. Let's suppose these are the 32 segments here. This is 3 segment and let's suppose this is 31st, okay. So this is 0, 1, 2 and so on, 31. It means there are 32 segments in the logical address space and each having the size of 1 kilobyte. So this complete space is 1 kilobyte. This complete space is again 1 kilobyte. So total logical address space size will be, what will it will be? 32 into 1 kilobyte. Okay. So it is basically 2 to the power 15 bytes. And let's suppose the memory is byte addressing. It means it can completely address 1 byte. Okay. This is 1 byte. This is second byte. This is third byte. So how many bits is required to identify uniquely these many bytes? This is 2 to the power 15 bytes and we have to uniquely identify these bytes. So there will be 15 bits required, 15 bits required in the logical address space to identify each byte uniquely. For example, if we have 4 bytes, okay, this 1, 2, 3 and 4. Let's suppose we have 4 byte means 2 to the power 4 byte we have and we have to uniquely identify these 4, then we will need only 2 bit address. What is 00, 01, 10 and then 11, okay. So in the similar manner of this, we required here 15 bits to identify 2 to the power 15 bytes uniquely. So the logical address space should have 15 bits. This is the answer. So in this question, in a lottery scheduler with 40 tickets, so there are 40 tickets, how we will distribute the tickets among 4 processes. So 4 processes and the 4 processes are P1, P2, P3 and P4 such that each process gets 10%, 5%, 6% and 25% respectively. So in the P1, if total is 40 tickets, okay, there is total 40 tickets and for P1 we have to give 10% of this 40 tickets. So what is the 10% of this 10 by so, which means it is having 4 tickets. And in P2 we have given 5%, so 5% of 40 will be 2. Okay, and 60% of 40, it will be given to P3 process. So 60% of the 40 will be 24, so 24 is given to this P3, and then 25% of 40 will be 10, and it is given to P4. So final answer is C here. Sorry, this is C is the answer. So in this question, suppose a system contains n process. So there are n process in the system. Okay, let's suppose this is P1, P2, P3 and so on, PN. These are the n processes in the system, and system uses the round robin algorithm for CPU scheduling. So it is using the round robin algorithm, and we know about the round robin algorithm. In round robin algorithm, there will be one time quantum or time stamp. Let's suppose this is time stamp, and the value of the timestamp is, let's suppose, 1 millisecond. Okay, so what it meant? It meant the time quantum. Okay, so in the round robin scheduling algorithm, each process will execute within the time, one time quantum. For example, first P1 will be executed for one time quantum, which is 1 millisecond, and then after this time quantum over, this P2 will be scheduled next. And this will be again executing 1 millisecond. Okay, so this will again execute till 1 millisecond because one time quantum. Then P3 will be scheduled, and it is also again scheduled with one time quantum. It means again it will execute 1 millisecond. So on. And after, let's suppose there are 4 processes. So after P4, 1 millisecond, and then again this P1 will be come here. Okay, so P1. 1 millisecond. So this is called the round robin scheduling algorithm. So the best data structure for the ready queue will be circular queue. Why I am using circular queue here? Because first, let's suppose all P1 to P4, there are 4 process, and all P1 to P4 comes in the time 0. Okay, so let's suppose P1, P2, P3, P4 all are coming at time 0, and I am using the subscript here 1, 2, 3, 4 to differentiate the order in which they will execute with their times quantum. Okay, so first P1 will be scheduled. So P1 is scheduled first. So P1 will be left removed from here. And then P1 is scheduling. And then when P1 is over with its time quantum, it completely executes with its time quantum. And when this time quantum overs, then this P1 will be scheduled here last. Okay, so it is going in this circular queue at the last position. Now again P2 is used. So when P2 complete its time quantum, it will again scheduled here, P1, P2. So basically this is circular queue, because P3 is coming and it is going here, P4 is coming and it is going here, and again this circle. Okay, so this is basically, if we use the ready queue as a circular queue, then it will be very helpful for that round robin algorithm. So answer is circular queue here. In this question, we have given a hard disk system has the following parameters: number of tracks, number of sectors per track, this and this, and rotation speed. And this is time taken by the head to move from one track to the adjacent track. Okay, so what is the average time taken for transferring 250 bytes from the disk? So average time will be average seek time. Average time taken for transferring this, how many bytes? Okay, here 250 bytes. So whenever we are asking the average time taken in transferring the bytes from the disk, so we have to consider three parameters here. First is average seek time, okay, average seek time. Then average rotational delay, this is the second point, second thing we have to consider here, rotational delay, average rotational delay. And the third thing is data transfer time, actual data transfer time. Okay, so these three things we have to add, and then we will get the answer here. So first is average seek time. So what is the seek time? Seek time is basically, if if head is in one track, let's suppose head is in the track number 1 and our required data starts from the track number 50. Let's suppose this is track number 50, our desired data will be start from here. So from this from this track number 1 to track number 50, head will have to move from track number 1 to track number 50. So the time taken by head to move from here to here is called the seek time. Okay, this is called the seek time. It means at the desired track, if we have to go the desired track, then it is called the seek time. Now we have to calculate average seek time, and we have given time taken by the head to move from one track to adjacent track equals to 1 millisecond. Okay, so how can we calculate the average seek time here? From track number 1 to track number 1, okay, from track number 1, if we have to go from track number 1 to track number 1, it is taking only 0 millisecond. Why? Because adjacent, if it so 1 to 2, from track number 1 to track number 2, it will take 1 millisecond. Why? Because we have given head to move from one track to the adjacent track is taking 1 millisecond. Then 1 to 3, it will take 2 millisecond, and then 1 to 4, it will take 3 millisecond. So we have total 500, number of tracks is 500. So from 1 to 500, it will take 499 millisecond. And now we these all are the seek time, and we have to calculate the average seek time here. So for the average, we have to sum all these numbers divided by total number. So actually 0 plus 1 plus 2 plus so on plus 499 divided by total number of, so how many numbers are track present here? This is 500. So average seek time will be, this is if I am consider this average seek time, so average seek time will be 499 into 500 divided by 2 into 500. So this will crossed, and the final answer will be 249 point, this is 4, 8, 1, okay, so 2 9s are 18, and then 1, so 249.5 millisecond. Okay, so average seek time here we have calculated 249.5 millisecond. Now we have to calculate average rotational delay here. So what is the average rotational delay? So rotational delay means we have given this, let's suppose here we have given rotational speed is 600 rotations per minute. It means the track, okay, the splendor will rotate 600 rotations in 1 minute. So 600 rotations in 1 minute, okay, if it is using 600 rotation in 1 minute, so how much time it will take to rotate one complete track? So it will take one complete rotation will take 1 divided by 600 minutes. Okay, and minutes we have to find this in the millisecond. So I am assuming here 60 seconds. Okay, so this is 60 second, minute we have to convert here. Now this is 1 by 10. Okay, so this is actually 1 by 10 seconds. So now 1 by 10 second, it means if we have to convert it millisecond, so it will be 100 millisecond. And for taking the average, because this is actual rotational delay, but we have to find the average rotational delay, and average rotational delay is a half of the rotational delay. So it means 50 millisecond. So 50 millisecond is the average rotational delay. So I have to add here 50 millisecond. Yes. Now these two things are done. Now we have to find the data transfer time for the 250 bytes. Okay. So data transfer time means, see here, it is taking 100 milliseconds. This is taking 100 milliseconds in one complete rotation. Okay. So 100 millisecond in one complete rotation. So in the 100 millisecond, it can transfer one complete track. Okay. And in one complete track, there are how many data bytes are present in one complete track? So in one track there are 100 sectors. This is 100 sector, and in each sector there are 500 bytes in one track. So in one track there are 100 sectors, and in each sector there are 500 bytes. So totally there are 50,000. There are 50,000 bytes. 50,000 bytes in one track. Okay, and in 100 millisecond one complete rotation will execute, and in one complete rotation one track will be complete track will be transferred. So here data transfer rate is like this: 15,000. This 15,000 bytes, this is byte actually, it is transferring in 100 milliseconds. Okay, this is 100 milliseconds, but we have to transfer 250 bytes. So for 250 bytes, it will take 250 into 100 divided by 50,000 milliseconds. So this much time it will take to transfer 250 bytes. So how much time it will take? This 0 0, and then this 0 here, this 0. So 25 divided by 50, it means 1/2, it means 0.5 millisecond. So it will take 0.5 millisecond to transfer this 250 bytes. So final answer will be here sum of these three, which is 249.5 plus 0.5, which is 250, and 250 plus 50, it is 300 millisecond. So this is the total time to transfer 250 bytes from this disk. So answer is 300 millisecond here. In this question, choose the correct alternatives. More than one may be correct, and write the corresponding letters only. At a particular time of a computation, the value of a counting semaphore, let's suppose this is counting semaphore, and value of at a particular time it is 7, then 20p operations and 15b operations were completed on this semaphore. So p, this p means it is wait operation or the down operation. So we have to 7 minus 22, and then 15b. So v means signal operation or up operation. It means 15b means 15 plus operations were completed on this semaphore. The resulting value of the semaphore is, so resulting value will be 15 plus 7, which is 22, minus 20, which is 2. So right answer will be 2 here. In this question, increasing the RAM of a computer typically improves performance because. So why a RAM of a computer, if we improve, if we increase the RAM, so why the computer improves its performance? So what is the reason behind this? We have to identify this. The first option here given is virtual memory increases. So this is not right, because virtual memory is different thing. Virtual memory is nothing related to RAM. Okay, so what is virtual memory here? This virtual memory concept itself is came into existence because of the shorter of RAM. So let's suppose there is smaller RAM. This is a smaller RAM. Let's suppose the total size of RAM is 2 MB. Let's suppose this is a hypothetical RAM of 2 MB, and our process, let's suppose our process, entire process size is around 10 MB. Okay. Now if we want to execute this process, and we want to fit into this RAM or main memory, then we cannot, if there will be contiguous memory location, then we cannot allocate this complete 10 MB process into RAM. So we introduce the concept of virtual memory, and with the help of virtual memory, what it means, the programmer or the application programmer assumes that there will be infinite RAM or infinite memory is present, and we can write any length of the program, any size of the program, and this computer, this CPU will, or this operating system will part this process, and whenever required, let's suppose at one point of time this instruction or these two instructions are required, so only these two parts will be present in this shorter RAM. So virtual memory is different concept with the RAM. So virtual memory increases, it is not right. Larger RAMs are faster, this is completely wrong. It is not making any sense. Larger RAMs are faster. The third one is fewer page faults occur. Yes, this is right actually. If we make the RAM bigger, it means our main memory is now bigger size. Okay. So if the main memory is bigger, it can accommodate more number of pages in the main memory, okay, in the RAM. So it is RAM. So now if RAM is bigger, so more number of pages can be present here. So less number of page faults occur. So what is page fault? If CPU is executing one process or one program and it is requesting one instruction in the program, and let's suppose one page, this is page number P1 and this page number P1, P2, P3, okay, and CPU executing this process in which there are three pages, P1, P2 and P4, these three pages are present. So let's suppose P1 is present. If CPU executing this complete process, it will request the page P1. So in this P1, let's suppose this is process, and in process P1, P2 and P4, three pages are there, and this is RAM or main memory. In the RAM there are P1, P2 are present, but P4 is not present. P3, some other process page is present, okay, like this, and this is RAM. So P1 and P2 are present in the main memory. So if CPU executing this process, it will first request this page, and this page is present, so CPU will go here and access this page. P2 is again here, so CPU will execute this page with this memory, but P4 is not present in the entire RAM. Okay, so this scenario is called the page fault. CPU is requesting this page, but this page is not present in the main memory or RAM. So this scenario is called the page fault. So whenever the page fault occurs, CPU will have to do some extra task, and it will take more time of the CPU. Why? Because first CPU will have to go here in the secondary memory. This process is stored in the secondary memory. Now this complete page P4 will be copied from this secondary memory, and it will take down from here to the RAM, okay. And let's suppose if RAM is fully filled, then there will have to apply some replacing algorithm, page replacement algorithm, and then P4 will be allocated in this main memory. So this is the page fault. So whenever page fault occurs, some extra time will be consumed by the program to execute. So if we increase the RAM, so if we increase this complete RAM, then more page can accommodate here, so less page faults will occur and our performance will be improved. Means we can execute process fastly, okay. So this is the right answer, fewer page faults occur here, okay. And last one is fewer segmentation faults occur. So if we increasing the RAM, then fewer segmentation faults occur. This is the wrong thing. Basically, what is the segmentation fault? It is also called seg fault. It is a common condition that causes program to crash. Means if segmentation fault occurs, the program will be crashed. Why this segmentation fault occurs? They are often associated with a file named core, these segment faults. And why they are occur? So segment faults or segmentation faults are caused by a program trying to read or write an illegal memory location. For example, if there is this process, okay, so let's suppose in main memory from 0 to 16 bytes this process is allocated, and if this process is executing in the CPU, so let's suppose from 0 to 16 byte in the main memory it is allocated to this process, but this process is trying to access, let's suppose, 30 to 64, okay, so illegal access. It is actually trying to access some different process code or the different location, memory location, which is not inside this process. So it is called a segmentation fault, okay. So it is clear that segmentation fault is not related to size of main memory. This statement is also false. So our right answer is fewer page faults occur. So in this question, consider the following program main and these three fork is actually the system call which will make the new process, and the new process will be exact copy of the parent process, okay. So how many new process will be created? So if there are n fork calls, okay, n fork calls are being executed, then the new process will be 2 to the power n minus 1 new process will be created, new processes, okay. So here 3 fork calls are called or executed, so there will be 2 to the power 3 minus 1, it means 7 new process will be created. So answer is 7 here. suppose two jobs, each of which needs 10 minutes of CPU time. So for example, this is P1 and this is P2. There are two jobs and each of which needs 10 minutes. So it is also required 10 minutes of CPU time. This is also required 10 minutes of CPU time. Start simultaneously. So both are arriving at the time 0 and 0. Now assume 50% IO wait time. So 50% IO wait time is assuming. How long will it take for both to complete if they run sequentially? Okay, so they are running in the sequential manner. So first in the 0, this P1 will become, let's suppose this P1 will be allocated to the CPU. So it will execute till 10. Okay, now from 10 this P1 will go to the IO. Okay, for IO, it is going for IO, and this again the P2 will come here, it will execute from 20, and it is saying that assume 50% IO wait time. Okay, so 50% IO wait time means, so our CPU will execute for 20 per, for totally 20 for 20, let's suppose this is millisecond. So our our CPU has executed for 20 time unit. Okay, for totally 20 time unit, and it is also saying that assume 50% IO wait time. So if the total execution time, let's suppose that this is total execution time contains the CPU time plus IO wait time. Okay, this is called the total execution time. So CPU time is 20, and let's suppose this total execution time is X. Okay, and it is saying that 50% IO wait time. Okay, so X of 50%, so X into 50 divided by, so it means X by 2. So here IO wait time is X by 2, and we have to calculate this total total execution time. How long it will take for both to complete, it means we have to find the total execution time. So it will X minus X by 2 equals to 20. So now we can calculate this as X by 2 equals to 20, which means X equals to 40. So this is the final answer. It means it will take 40 time unit for both to complete totally. So this is the right answer. Okay. In this question, if a node has k children in B tree, then the node contains exactly how many keys? Okay. So in the B tree, if this is one block, okay. So one block, actually the structure of B tree is like, if the order of B tree is, let's suppose 3. So what is order here? Order means in this block maximum 3 children pointer can be present. So order of 3 means maximum 3 children pointer. It is one children pointer, it is second. Okay, this is second and this is third children. It means the children, number of children of this block will be 3 children. So again, this is one block, this is again one block, and this is again one block. And between each two pointers, this is one pointer which can have the address of this block, and it is again one pointer which can have the address of this block. So between all the these two pointers, there will be one key plus record pointer. Okay, so one key plus record pointer. So I am, suppose record pointer is PR. So one key plus PR here, and one key plus PR will be here. Okay, so this is called the B tree. In the B tree, this is the structure of the B tree. So if there is K children, means the pointer of this node is K. It means there will be K pointers or K children. So order will be K here. So how many keys will be present here? Here one key will be present, here one key will be present, and so on, one key will be present here. So totally, if let's suppose the order is 3 here, so two keys can be present in the block. So similarly, if order is K or K pointer can be present, then there will be K minus 1 key will be present in this block. So answer is K minus 1 here. The time complexity of the following C function is, assume n greater than 0. So if it is the recursive function, let's suppose the time complexity is tn, let's suppose this is tn, then if n equals to 1, then return 1. So t1 will return 1 here, okay, and else return recursive n minus 1 means again this function is calling n minus 1 plus n minus 1, so 2 times n minus 1. So time complexity will be like tn equals to 2 times of t n minus 1 and plus 1 for the constants. So let's suppose this is constant, so plus 1 for this condition checking or comparison. So it is taking constant time for condition checking and then again calling 2 times of t of n minus 1, and in this we have given t1 equals to 1. So let's suppose we are now calculating t2. So t2 will be 2 times of t1 plus 1, okay, and so this is basically 2 plus 1. So t2 is, this is t2, t2 is 2 into 1 plus 1. Now let's suppose we are calculating t of 3, then t of 3 will be 2 times of t of 2 plus 1. So this is t2, so I am putting the value 2 plus 1 here, so it will be 2 times of 2 plus 1 plus 1. This is t3, so basically t3 is now, if I am calculating this here, so 2 square plus 2 plus 1, okay. So similarly if I calculate t of n, so t of n will be 2 to the power n minus 1. Similarly here if t3 equals to 2 to the power 2, so tn equals to 2 to the power n minus 1 plus 2 to the power n minus 2 plus so on plus 2 to the power 1 plus 2 to the power 0, which is 1. This is 1, which means 2 to the power 0 here, it is similar, okay. So now this is a geometric progression, and in this geometric progression each terms having the common ratio of 2, okay. So we can calculate, or we know the sum of geometric progression, which is Sn equals to n terms of geometric progression a into r to the power n minus 1. So a r to the power n minus 1 upon r minus 1. So this r is a common ratio, okay. So here common ratio is 2, and first term is, let's suppose this is our first term, 2 to the power 0. So I am putting here 1, 2 to the power 0 means 1 into r to the power n. So common ratio is 2. So 2 to the power, how many terms are here from 0 to n minus 1? 0, 1, 2 and then so on n minus 1. So totally n terms are there. So 1 into 2 to the power n minus 1 upon 2 minus 1 means 1. So final answer is here tn equals to 2 to the power n minus 1. So we can represent it in order terms. So it will be t of n will be order of 2 to the power n. So this is right. D option is correct here. In this question, the number of spanning trees for a complete graph with 7 vertices is. So first we need to understand what is the complete graph. In the complete graph, every pair has one edge. Okay. So for example, this is the complete graph of 4 vertices, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Then all the vertices, this, all the possible pairs having one edge, and this is called the complete graph. So in the complete graph, how many number of spanning trees possible? So there is one formula for the complete graph. If there are n nodes, then n to the power n minus 2 different spanning trees are possible in the case of complete graphs. So if let's suppose this is complete graph of having 4 nodes, so 4 to the power 4 minus 2, it means 16 spanning trees are possible here. So similarly, if we have given this complete graph with 7 vertices, then there will be 7 to the power 5, this much spanning trees are possible. So answer is B here. In this question, if one uses a straight two-way merge sort algorithm to sort the following elements in ascending order, so these are the elements and we have to sort these elements using the two-way merge sort. Okay, so we have to tell order of these elements after second pass of the algorithm. So first, in the first, we have to apply here merge sort algorithm. So let's suppose these are the elements of array 20, 47, 15, 8, 9, 4, 40, 30, 12 and 17. So these are the elements we have to sort using merge sort algorithm. So since this is the two-way merge, so these two elements will be first compare, okay, and the smaller element should be present in the left hand side. So 20, 47, so 20 will remain in this position and 47 here. Now this 15 and 8 will be compared next, and 8 will come here and 15 will come here. This 9 and 4, since 4 is less than 9, so 4 will come left to the 9 like this. And now 40, 30, so 30 will be here and 40 will be here, and 12 and 17, 12 will be here and 17 remains the same position. So since this is the first pass of the merge sort algorithm, so now we have compared two elements. Now these two elements are sorted, and these two elements is one separate list. In the merge sort algorithm, first it will compare two elements, and then these two, this is complete one sorted list, and this is one complete sorted list. Similarly, this is one complete sorted list, and this is one another sorted list, and this is one another sorted list. Now in the second pass, these two lists will be compared together, and we will apply the merge procedure here with this sorted list and with this sorted list. So when the merge procedure applied in these two sorted list, it will give 8, 15, then 20 and 47. Okay, so this will now one complete sorted. Now this two list will be given as an input to the merge procedure. So when merge procedure applied in these two list, it will give 4, 9, 30 and 40. Okay, so this is one complete list, and 12 and 17 remains same. Okay, so this is the scenario after the second pass of the merge sort algorithm. So our answer will be 8, 15, 20, 47, 4, 9, 30, 40, 12, 17. This will be the order of these elements after second pass of the algorithm. So answer is B here. And if again we applied the merge procedure in these two sorted list, then it will give the smaller element is 4, so 4, 8, 9, 15, 4, 8, 9, 15, and then 20, then 30, then 40, and then 47, and this 12 and 17 will remain same. Now this is one complete sorted list, and this is another sorted list. So after this pass, this is the third pass of the merge sort algorithm, and after the last pass, which is the fourth pass, in the fourth pass all these elements will be sorted. So this is one sorted list and this is one sorted list. When we applied the merge procedure here between these two sorted lists, it will give 4, 8, 9, then 12. This 12 will come here, then 15, then 17, then 20, 30, 40 and 47. So this is after the fourth pass. So our answer, in the question it is asking, after the second pass, what is the order of these elements? So order of these elements after the second pass will be this, B. So this is answer. So in this question, we have given R1 and R2 be the regular sets. So these are two regular sets, R1 and R2. Now this defined over the alphabet. Let's suppose some alphabet sigma equals to AB. This is the alphabet set. This R1 and R2 are two regular sets here. So R1 intersection R2 is not regular. This is false, because we know that regular sets or regular languages are closed under intersection, union, intersection, concatenation, clean closure, and all these operations. Difference, set difference. So regular sets are closed under all these operations. But here it is saying R1 intersection R2 is not regular, which is false. R1 union R2 is not regular. This is also false. Sigma star minus R1 is regular. So this is sigma star, which is all possible strings in this alphabet, minus R1, minus this regular set R1 or regular language R1. So this is basically, or this is actually, this is R1 complement. This complete thing, this is not. So sigma star minus R1 is actually R1 complement. Okay, and we know that the regular languages or regular sets are closed under union, concatenation, intersection, clean closure and complementation also. So this R1 complementation is also one regular set. Okay, so it is here saying this sigma star minus R1 is regular. This is true. R1 star is not regular. This is also false. So answer is C here. In this question, the DNS maps the IP address to. So we know what is the meaning of DNS. DNS is basically full form as domain name server. So domain name service or domain name server. So what is the use of this DNS? Actually, DNS is a directory in which it is basically one server. In this server, there will be directory. And in this directory, each IP address or each domain name, this is, let's suppose, domain name, and this domain name maps with one IP addresses. Okay, so what is this domain name and what is IP address? Let's suppose we are typing this www.google.com in our browser, in web browser. So our machine does not know this IP address of this Google, which is domain name. This google.com is called the domain name, and our IP address is, our machine has not know the IP address of this google.com. so basically it will tell DNS server, or it will ask the DNS server. So now DNS server will map this domain name corresponding to the IP address. Okay, so this DNS will tell the IP address of this domain name and return the IP address to our machine, so that our machine can communicate with this IP address or with this domain name. So this is the answer. So DNS maps the IP address to a binary address as strings. Actually, the DNS maps the IP address to a hierarchy of domain names. Yes. So DNS maps the IP address to the hierarchy of a domain names. This is the right answer. So to add a background color for all H1 elements, which of the following HTML syntax is used? So we have to add color for all these H1 tags. Okay. So whenever the H1 element present in our HTML file, let's suppose this is one HTML file and there are one or two H1 heading, or this H1 tags are present. So now if we want to set the background color for these H1 tags, then what is the syntax? It is saying what is the syntax used in HTML. So the syntax here is like this: H1. If we have to color or set the background color for H1, so we will write in the CSS like H1 here, and in H1 we will do like this: background color, okay, color, and then this is colon will come, and now for all H1 we are setting here 6 time F, which is 15. Okay, so F. This is the common syntax for setting the background color for this H1 tag, for all H1 tags. So this is the answer A. The correct syntax to write hi there in JavaScript. So we have to write if hi there, we have to print hi there in JavaScript. So what should be the correct syntax in JavaScript? So if we want to write or print anything in the display in server side, okay, so there are two things can be occur: if we want to print on the client side or if we want to print on the server side. Okay, so if we want to print anything like this hi there, we have to print in the client side, then we will use this syntax document dot write function. Okay, so always this document dot write is the function for printing the for printing any string in the client side. Okay, so document.write, and if suppose I have to print hi there, so I will print like this. But this is not coming. Okay, but if I have to print in the server side, then there will be another thing like response. Okay, so in the server side we'll have to print like response.write function, and in this argument will be hi there. This is okay. So there are two things, whether we have to print on the server side or client side. If we have to print on the server side, then we will use this function response.write, and if we have to print on the client side, we will use this document.write. So here it is nothing, the correct syntax to write hi there in JavaScript. It is nothing here, it is not saying about the server side or client side. So we'll use generally this response.write, which is on the server side. So this is the right answer, response.write hi there. So in this question, we have to identify, to declare the version of XML, the correct syntax is. So whenever we have to make this XML, okay, if we have to make XML document, we have to define the version in the initial or in the starting position, we have to define the version. So for defining the version, the syntax will be like this. This is then XML and then version equals to, let's suppose we are using 1.0 version, so 1.0, okay, and this symbol and then this. So this is the correct syntax for defining the version in any XML document. Question mark XML version equals to 1.0, like this. Okay, so answer is C here. Correct answer will be C here. So in this, a T switch is used to. So T switch is basically one device which is used to rearrange the connections between computing equipments. Okay, for example, if in one network there are so many devices, okay, and they all are connected with one network, okay, in this network. So when we use the T switch, it will rearrange the connections between those computing equipments or those devices. Okay, so T switch is used for this purpose, rearranging the connections here. What frequency range is used for microwave communications, satellite and radar? So the name says this is microwave communications. Okay, so microwave means their wavelength is very very small. Okay, so their wavelength is very small. So there is one relation. If let's suppose this is wavelength and this is frequency, then frequency is in inversely proportional to the wavelength. Okay, so since there are very less wavelengths, microwave communications or satellite and radar have very less wavelengths, so their frequency is extremely high. So your answer is extremely high frequency, from 30,000 kilohertz. This is the range of frequency of this microwave communications, satellite and radar. So answer here is extremely high frequency, 30,000 kilohertz. So in this question, how many bits internet address is assigned to each host on a TCP/IP internet which is used in all communication with the host? Okay, so let's suppose this is one host in our network and this is one another host in our network, and they are using the TCP/IP protocol or TCP/IP stack. This is also TCP/IP and this is TCP/IP. So if they want to communicate with each other, it means we have to communicate this host to host, this host to this host. So they have to assign, we have to assign some unique number in the network layer so that they can identify uniquely. Okay, each host can be identified uniquely. So this is the number here. IP addresses are used for this purpose, and IP addresses in the TCP/IP protocol is having the 32 bits IP addresses. If I am using the IPv4 address, then it is 32 bits IP addresses or 32 bits numbers. So in this question, how many bits internet address? So this is also called internet address, IP address. So it is assigned to each host on a TCP/IP internet, so which is used in all communication with the host. So IPv4 address is 32 bits. So right answer is 32 bits. Nowadays IPv6 is also popular, and IPv6 address is the 128 bits address. But here we are using the IPv4, so 32 bits is the correct answer. So in this question, how many characters per second 7 bits plus 1 parity can be transmitted over a 2400 BPS line if the transfer is synchronous? So there are two types of transmission. One is synchronous transmission and one is asynchronous transmission. Okay, so for the asynchronous transmission, we should know one start and stop bits for each frame. Let's suppose this is the character sequence. So every character sequence start with one special bit and end with one stop bit. Okay, so end with one stop. So this is the asynchronous transfer. But since the transmission is synchronous, so we need not to put one start and one stop bit. So only the character will be transmitted, because this is in the synchronized manner. Okay, so all character directly can be transmitted here. So in the synchronous transmission, this start and stop bit is not useful. Okay, start and stop bit is not used in the synchronous system. So now in the question, it is given that there is over a 2400 bits per second line. It means the frequency or the bandwidth here is 2400 bits per second, 1 second. So in the 1 second, it can transfer 2400 bits. Okay, so now we have to tell how many characters per second can be transmitted. Okay, so here the character is given as 7 bits for the data and plus 1 bit for parity. So totally one character is consist of 8 bits. Okay, so one character, it means 8 bits. So now we have to tell in 1 second how many characters we can transmit. Okay, so in 1 second 2400 bits can transmit. So if I am converting this 2400 bits into character, so 2400 bits divided by 8 bits, because one character is consist of 8 bits, so it will tell around 300. Okay, so 300 characters. So in 1 second we can transmit 300 characters. So this is the answer. In this question, in CRC, if the data unit is this is data unit and the divisor is this. Okay, so CRC divisor is this and data unit is this, then what is the dividend at the receiver? Okay, so in the CRC system, since this is the divisor and divisor is having 4 bits, so 3 bit CRC will be added into this data unit. Okay, so we have to find that 3 bit CRC. Okay, so we can find the 3 bit CRC using this 2 modulo division arithmetic here. We are using here. So now we have to find the CRC of 3 bit. So since this is 4, so I am adding 3 0 bits or appending the 3 zeros in this data unit. So 1 0 0 1 1 1 0 0 1, and appending 3 0 bits to find the actual CRC here. So this is, and the CRC divisor is 1 0 1 1. Okay, since this first bit is 1, so I have to copy this complete divisor here. So 1 0 1 1. Now I have to add this in the 2 modulo arithmetic, or I have to subtract this from this in the 2 using the 2 modulo arithmetic. So 1 1 1, basically we have to take XOR of these 2 bits. So 1 1 XOR 1 is 0. Now, sorry, this one and this one, okay, this one and this one, 1 XOR 1 0, 1 XOR 0 1, 0 XOR 0 0, and this is cross, this is of no use. Now I am writing this one here. So this one, since the first bit is 0 now, so we have to write 0 0 0 0 4 bits here. Again do the XOR, so 1 0 1 0 0 0 1 0 1 0, this cross. Now writing this one here, since first bit is 1, so 1 0 1 1, it will give me 1 cross 1 XOR 0 1 1 1 XOR 0 0, and this is cross. Now writing this 0 here, again the first bit is 0, so I have to write 0 0 0 0 and subtract this from this using the 2 modulo arithmetic. So basically we have to take XOR, so 0 0 0 and this is cross. Now writing this 0 here, okay, so writing this 0 again, 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 will come. Now writing this one here, so this one will make now again 0 0 0 0, so it will give 1 0 0 and cross. Now 0 0 1 and writing this 0 here, so I'm writing now here, so 0 0 1 0, since this is first bit is 0, so appending 0 all 4 0, 0 0 0 1 0 1 0 and cross. Now writing this 0, okay, so 0 0 0 0 0 0, this is 1 and this is cross. Now this is the last 0 I am writing here, this last 0, so first bit is 1, so I have to write this 1 0 1 1 here, 1 0 1 1, now 1 0 1 1 0 XOR 1, this is 0 and this is cross. So this is our final CRC, so 0 1 1 will be the final CRC here. So now I have to append this 3 bit CRC into the data unit. So what is our data unit? 1 0 0 1 1 1 0 0 1 and this 0 1 1. So this will be complete data unit and it will be sent from sender to receiver, and at the receiver side this will be the dividend to calculate the CRC. So this will be the dividend at the receiver. So what is answer here? 1 0 0 1 1 1 0 0 1 and then 0 1 1. So B is the answer, correct answer. In this question we have given ACK number, or it is called acknowledgement number of 1000. In TCP it is always means that, so if acknowledgement number is 1000, so basically acknowledgement number tells in the TCP that what is the next byte a receiver can expect. Okay, so receiver is expecting next byte as 1000, which is to be sent by sender. So next byte, what is the receiver expecting the next byte, this tells the acknowledgement number. So let's suppose if the initial sequence number in the byte is 0, means the first byte which is sent by the sender to receiver, it is having the sequence number as 0, this byte, this complete byte as 0, then at the 1000, if ACK is 1000, so it will tell now the sender, now the receiver expecting the byte number 1000 here. Okay, so 0 to 999 bytes are correctly received by the receiver. So 1000, 0 to 999 means totally 1000 bytes are successfully received by the receiver. This is significance of this acknowledgement number 1000. So here 1000 bytes have been successfully received. This is also right, but if let's assume that in the first byte the sequence number start with 1, let's suppose this is first byte and the sequence number of this is 1, so now acknowledgement number 1000 represents that now receiver expecting the next byte to be received as a 1000. Okay, so 1 to 999, these many bytes are completely received by the receiver. Okay, so here 999, this is 1 to 999, which means 999 bytes have been successfully received by the receiver. So this is also possible and this is also possible. So in this question it is not given that the first byte is start with 0 or 1. So both these two are the wrong, actually both two are possible, but we are not definitely decide that this is right or this is right. So here answer will be none of the above. It means we cannot decide. So first we should know the sequence number of the first byte, then we will decide if 999 bytes have been successfully received or 1000 bytes have been successfully received. Okay, so both these two are possible, but this is not possible. So answer is none of the above here in this question.
in this question, in a class B subnet, okay, so this is the class B subnet. We know the IP address of one host and the mask as given below. So this is IP address of class B network, and this is actually one class B network subnet, okay. So IP address is 125.134.112.66. This is IP address of the host, and this is the subnet mask, which is given as 255.255.224.0. So what is the first address or network address? So to identify the network address, we'll have to do the bitwise AND of this IP address with the subnet mask. So subnet mask is given as 255.255.224. This is 224.0. Okay. So this is the subnet mask, and we have to do bitwise AND operator here between this and this. So since this is 255, it means all in this octet, all the bits are 1. Why? Because 8 bits represent 255 in decimal. Okay, this is 3, this is 3, and this is completely 255 in decimal. So if we are doing bitwise AND with this 255 with this 125, then answer will be 125 here. So 125, again this 2 134, and we are doing bitwise AND with 255, which is all 1 in the octet, so it will again result as 134, same as this. Now this is 112, and this is 224. So we have to now convert this 112 into the binary format. So 112 means, let's suppose this is 128th position bit, so I'm putting it as 0. Now 64, okay, and we can hear 64 plus 32, it is 6 and 96. 64 plus 32, 96. So in the 32 bit position, I am putting 1. Now 96 and 16, okay, 96 and 16 is 6612. Okay, so this is 112. So this bit is 1, and all the remaining 4 bits are 0 here. So this is actually 112 in the binary. And now this 224, I want to convert it into also binary, that so that I can do the bitwise AND operator of this and this. So now 224 will be 128th bit will be 1, and then 128 plus 64, which is 192, I think, yeah, 192. Okay, so now 192 and 32, which is 224, yeah, 224. So this is 128, this is 64, this is 32, and now all remaining bits are 0 here. Okay, so this is, so 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, and this is 1 2 3 4 5, yeah. So now I have to do, this is actually 224. Now I have to do the bitwise AND between this and this. So 0 0 0 0 and 0 0 and 0 0 0 and 0 0 0 and 1, it is also giving 0. 1 and 1 will give 1, 1 and 1 will give 1, and 1 and 0 will give again 0. So this is, so if I have to convert into this binary format, into the, I should convert this into the decimal so that I can match with the answer. So now this is actually 64 plus 32, it means this is 96, okay. This is 64, this is 32, 64 plus 32, which is 96, okay. So, and this is 0 and this is 66. So when we do the bitwise AND between this 0 and 66, it will completely give 0. So 125.134.96.0. So our network address or first address of this subnet will be this 125.134.96.0. So this is the answer. In this question, a certain population of Aloha users manages to generate 70 requests per second. So in 1 second, these population can generate 70 requests in 1 second, okay. And if the time is slotted in units of 50 milliseconds, okay. So since in Aloha there is the time slotted, okay, so time is slotted for the different users, and each time slot is having 50 milliseconds. So
50 milliseconds, okay, this is 50 millisecond. In this 50 millisecond, only one time slot, okay, so one time slot for 50 milliseconds. So in 1 second, how many time slots can be present? So in 1 second, okay, I want to convert this to 1 second, okay, 1 second into one time slot. Let's suppose time slot TS divided by 50 millisecond, and 50 millisecond means 10 to the power minus 3 seconds. Okay, so from this second, we'll cancel out this second. Now 1 by 50 into 10 to the power minus 3. So this is basically 1000 divided by 50 time slots. These many time slots will present in 1 second. Okay, so time slot. So this is basically 20 time slots. So in 1 second, there are 20 number of time slots can be occurred. Okay, so now we have to calculate the channel load, and the channel load is actually, this is channel load we have to calculate, channel load, and the channel load is the ratio of number of requests divided by number of time slots. Okay, so number of request divided by, this is number of request divided by number of time slots. So in 1 second, number of request is 70, because 70 request per second, and in 1 second there are 20 time slots, so 70 by 20, so which means the channel load will be 3.5. okay, so this is the answer here. In this question, which statement is false? We have to identify which statement is false here. So ping is a TCP IP application that sends datagrams once every second in the hope of an echo response from the machine being pinged. Yes, this statement is true actually, because ping is a TCP IP application. It is one application and it sends datagram once every second. So it will send datagrams in every second in the hope of an echo response. Echo response means, if it is sending the datagrams in every 1 second, so it will be actually hoping the echo response. It means, let's suppose we have typed ping, this ping command, and www.google.com. So in which machine this command is typed, that machine will send datagrams once every second into this Google's machine, okay, www.google.com, this servers or this machines, and echo response from this Google machine will be generated and sent from the Google or from this machine to the host, which is typed the ping command. Okay, so it is called the echo response from the machine being pinged. So this is the machine being pinged. So this statement is true. If the machine is connected and running a TCP IP protocol stack, it should respond to the ping datagram with a datagram of its own. Yes, this is right. Ping is also used to check the self connectivity. Okay, so if a machine is connected and running a TCP IP protocol stack, so it should respond, or it will be respond the ping command if ping is typed by the own this machine only. Okay, so this will also respond, so that machine will also respond. Okay, so this is also called the loopback. Okay, so loopback, it is used to check the connectivity of our machine to the network. So third option is, if ping encounters an error condition and ICMP message is not returned. This statement is false, because if ping encounters an error condition, it will send, that machine will send one ICMP. Okay, this ICMP message is also generated and sent and returned from that machine to the this machine which have typed the ping command. And the last option is, ping display the time of the return response in milliseconds or one of several error messages. This is also true. When in the machine ping is typed or ping command is executed, then this command will display the time of the return response by the pinged machine. Okay, so it will display the return response of the pinged machine in milliseconds or if the ping is not successfully executed, then it will show the error message also. So this statement is also true. So only false statement is this C option. In this question, a routing table is given. So this is one router's routing table, and packet bearing a destination address equals to this arrives at the router. On which interface will it be forwarded? Okay, so first router will check the network address of this address. If this is the address or destination address, then router will identify the network address or network address in which this host belongs to, and then that this packet will be forwarded to that network with this interface. Okay, so now how can router identify the network address of this host? So it will do the bitwise AND operation with this and the subnet mask of the network. Okay, so for example, in the first, let's suppose this is our destination address 144.16.68. This is 68 and 117. This is the destination address. So first it will do the AND bitwise AND operation with this subnet mask 255.255.0.0. So when I do the bitwise AND of this 255.255.0.0, it will give me 144.16.68 and bitwise AND of 0, so it will give 0, and again here 0 and bitwise AND of 117, it will give 0. So this will be the network address. So 144.16.0.0, and this network address is matched with this network address. So router can transfer this destination address, this packet, to this network through interface ETH0. But first router will check this destination address with all the available network addresses. Okay, so this is one, it can transfer it to Ethernet 0 or this interface. Now it will again do the bitwise AND operation with the second network subnet mask 144.16.68.117, and the subnet mask of the second network is 255.255.224.0. okay, this is, so now 68 is, this is 128, this is 64, 32, 68, 64 plus 4 is 68, so 4, 2, 1. Okay, so this is 68 and this is 224. So 224 is this and this. This is 224. So when we do the bitwise AND here, so 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. So it will give 64, okay? So it will give completely 144. This is 144, this is 16 here, 68 and 224, it will give 64 and then 0. So again, this network is also matched. Second network is also matched. So router can transfer this destination address packet to this interface with this network. Why? Because in this subnet mask, this is 255.255.0.0. So here totally 16 ones are present in the subnet mask. Here 16 ones are present, 8 here and 8 here. And here 8 plus 8 plus 3. So here 19 ones are present. So router will send this network this host address or destination address to that subnet mask which is having more number of ones. Okay, so now since this is also matched and this is also matched, so if router has these two choices, so router will send this packet to this network through Ethernet 1. Now again router will check from bitwise AND operation of this with the third subnet mask. So if it is doing this, since the subnet mask of the third network is 255.255.255.0, okay, and our destination address is 144, this is 144.16.168.117, so this is 255, so it will completely give 144 here if I am doing the bitwise AND, because here all are the 1. Again, this is all are 1, so it will give 16. Here it will give 68 and 255. Again, it will give 68 and here it will give 0. So now you can see that this network address is also matched with this network address. So router can transfer here in this network also. And since here the number of 1s are in the subnet mask is 8 plus 8 plus 8, which is 24. So router will send this packet to this network through Ethernet 2. Now it will again doing the bitwise AND operation with the net, with the given destination address with the fourth subnet mask. So now if it will do like this, so this is 255 144, so it will give 144.16.68, and now here 117 and here 224. So 224 means this is 224 325 38. Yes, and 117 is actually like this. This is 0 64 plus 32, which is 96, and 96 plus 32, okay, sorry, 64 plus 32, 96, and 96 plus 16, which is 112. Okay, so this is 112, and now 5 more. Okay, so 8 will 0 and this 4. Yeah, so this is 117 and this is 224. Now it will do the bitwise AND operation 0 0 0 0 0 1 1 and 0. Okay, so the value of this is 64 plus 32, which is 96 here. So here the network address is 144.16.68.96, but the given network address here is 144.16.68.64. So this network address is not matched with this network address, so router cannot send the destination into this network. So now between these three choices, the router will send this destination's address or this packet into that subnet mask of into that network which is having the subnet mask in which more number of 1s are present. So number of 1s are here 24, so router will send this packet in which destination address is this to this network, okay, with the use of interface ETH2. So final answer here is ETH2 is the right answer. Which layers of the OSI reference model are host to host layers? Okay, so OSI reference models have totally 7 layers, which is like this application layer, which is in the topmost position, then presentation layer, and then session layer, then transport layer. Okay, this is transport layer, and then there is network layer, then data link layer, and then physical layer. Okay, so these are the 7 layers of the OSI reference model, and in the OSI reference model these 4 layers, okay, this application, presentation, session, and transport, these 4 layers are called the host layers. This is host layers, and these 3 layers, network, DLL, and physical, this is called the media layer. Okay, this is also called media layer. So now in this question they are asking which are the host to host layers. So transport, session, presentation, and application, this is the right answer. Okay, so this is right answer, and in these 3, application layer, presentation layer, session layer, in these 3 layers the protocol data unit, it means the term or the data unit is called as data, okay, complete data. And in the transport layer the data unit is called as segment in the TCP protocol. And if the transport layer is using the UDP protocol, then it is called the term datagram in UDP. Okay, and in network layer this is called packet. This protocol data unit means data unit is called packet. And in the data link layer it is called frame, and in the physical layer it is simply a bit. Okay, so this is the protocol data unit for all the layers, and host layers are these: application, presentation, session, and transport. This is the right answer. in this question, the minimum time delay between the initiation of two independent memory operation is called. Okay, so let's suppose these are the two independent, this is instruction number one and this is instruction number two. These two are the independent memory operation. So when this A1 is executing, then A1 is executed, okay, and after some time, let's suppose this is the time period, after this time period, this memory operation A2 will be executed next. So this is the time, it is called a cycle time. This is the definition of cycle time. So minimum time delay between the initiation of two independent memory operation, this is called as cycle time. This is right. Which of the following compression algorithm is used to generate a .png file? Okay, so .png file. So which of the compression algorithm is used here? So png file is actually the non-patented lossless data compression file. Means in this algorithm, this deflect algorithm is used for compression of the png file. So answer is deflect algorithm for the png file. Okay, for this is actually a compression algorithm. Okay, so it will generate non-patented lossless data compression. So deflect is used to generate a .png file, this compression algorithm. Dirty bit for a page in a page table. It helps avoid unnecessary writes on a paging device. This is right. So what is the dirty bit here? So let's suppose in the cache or in the paging device, this is page table. This is one page table. And in this page table, there is information about each page. Okay, let's suppose this is page number 1, which is page number 2, page number 3, page number 4. And this complete process, this is actually the page table of that process, na? Page table. And the complete process is already inside the secondary storage. Let's suppose this is secondary storage. Okay, secondary memory or secondary storage. In this complete process is already present. Let's suppose this is process P and page number P1, P2, P3 and so on. PN is present in the secondary storage. Okay, but now let's suppose this is page table of the page table of this process P, and in this page table there is one information that is called the dirty bit. Okay, so dirty bit is one bit which is used to avoid unnecessary writes on paging device. So what it means, for example, if this P1 is now inside the page table and it is already inside the main memory of RAM. Okay, so this P1 is inside the main memory, P2, P3 all are present here. Okay, for example, these many pages are present in main memory. So now let's suppose some other page request like P6 is want to accommodate. So CPU wants to execute this page number 6, P6. Okay, and this P6 wants to accommodate in the main memory, but main memory is full. Okay, and let's suppose P1 is the page which have to replace here to accommodate P6, this page. Okay, so now CPU will this P1 okay so CPU will go into this page table of this process and see that is their dirty bit is set or not. So what is the dirty bit? It means if the P1 is modified, this page which is loaded in main memory, if this is modified or this is changed something, then the dirty bit corresponding to this page will be set as 1. Okay, so if dirty bit is set as 1, then we need to transfer this, we need to, when we are replacing this page, okay, so when we are replacing this page, then we need to go into the secondary storage and also change this page. Okay, because this is the old copy of this page and we have modified this page. How can the CPU know or how can OS know that this page is modified? So this will tell by the dirty bit. Since dirty bit is set as 1, so CPU will get to know that this P1 or this page will be modified, or this page has modified. Okay, so this P1, whenever this P1 is replaced from the main memory, so CPU first go to the secondary storage and then write again this page in the secondary memory. But let's suppose this page P1 is not modified, So dirty bit of this page is set as 0. Okay, so since this page is not modified, so CPU directly will replace this page and accommodate P6 here. It need not to go again and write the same page into the secondary storage. So this effort is saved by the dirty bit concept. Okay, so it helps avoid the unnecessary writes on a paging device. So in this case, it is need not to write again if this page is not modified. So need not to write again in the secondary storage when we have to replace this page from the main memory. So this is the answer. Helps maintain LRU information. This is not right. Allows only read on a page. It is also not right. None of the whole is not answer. So our answer is A. Helps avoid unnecessary writes on a paging device. Which of the following is not an image type used in MPEG? So in the MPEG, this B frame is used as an image, D frame is and preframe is also used as an image type in the MPEG. But this A frame is not used an image type. Okay, so this is not right. This A frame is not valid. So answer is here A frame. In this question, consider an uncompressed stereo audio signal of CD quality which is sampled at 44.1 kHz. So here sample frequency is given as 44.1 kHz. This is the sample frequency. Okay, so now it is quantized using 16 bits. Okay, so what is the meaning of here it is quantized using 16 bits? It means this signal, one sound signal, it needs 16 bits. Okay, so one sound signal required 16 bits here. One sound signal required the 16 bits. Okay, so this is the meaning of this line. Now what is the required storage space if a compression ratio of 0.5 is achieved for 10 seconds of this audio? Okay, so this is sample frequency which is given 44.1 kHz. We can write it as 44.1 into 1000 divided by this is kilohertz. So 1000 means it is this much, 44.1 into 1000 hertz, and this hertz we can write it as 1 by second. Okay, because it is frequency. Now this is the sample frequency and one sound signal needs 16 bits, and since this is the stereo audio signal, okay, this audio signal is a stereo audio signal, so there will be two channels present in the stereo audio signal. Every stereo audio signal, it needs two channel. So what is the bit rate here? So I want to find the bit rate here, or how many bits per second it need. Okay, so since sample frequency is this, so 44.1 into 1000, so it means 44 100. This is frequency divided by seconds. Okay, so it is into, this is into actually into divide, this is divided by second, or we can write like this 44 100 divided by second. This is the frequency of the audio signal. Into one audio signal needs 16 bits, so 16 bits here. And this is stereo audio, so that's why two channels will be present. So I am multiplying here it with 2. So now it will given as, when I calculate this, the 141 120, it these many bits per second. Okay, so this is the bits per second. Now this is our bandwidth, required bandwidth here. So now in this question, it is using the compression ratio as 0.5. okay, so we have to compress this bandwidth in the ratio of 0.5. so now our actual bandwidth or bits per second will be 14 11 200 into 0.5, which is 1 by 2 here. So it, if I do the half here, so it will give the value as 7 0 now 5, then 6 12 double zero. Yeah, so this is the value 7,05,600. This is 600 bits per second. This is our actual bandwidth. Now we can see here that in 1 second it can generate 7,05,600 5600 bits, okay, in 1 second. So in the question they have said we have to identify for the 10 seconds of this audio. So for 10 second it will take, for 10 second it will take 10 into this, it means 705600, and this zero is also there, okay. So this many bits will be present for 10 second in this audio signal. Now all the answers are here in the kilobytes, okay. So first we need to convert it into byte. So byte, this is this will give me byte, and again if I am doing this this will give 8, okay. Now again I have to convert it into kilobyte, so I am dividing it with 1024, okay, 1024. So when we calculate this, it will give us 861.33 kilobyte, okay. So this will be the answer, 861.33 kilobyte. So actually this is right answer, 860 kilobyte, because we are doing the round figure here. 860 kilobyte is the right answer here. In this question, what is the compression ratio in a typical MP3 audio files? So audio is recorded in the frequency like 44.1 kilohertz, okay. So this is the 44.1 kilohertz is the recorded or sample frequency for the audio files. While converting to MP3, 16 bits are used to represent one sound signal. So one sound signal is actually 16 bits. Now for stereo audio, or okay, so MP3 audio files are the stereo audio files, and for the stereo audio we use two channels, okay. So now two channels of 16 bit audio at 44.1 kilohertz, okay. So it will give like 2 into 16 bits into the frequencies 44.1 into 1000, because it is kilohertz, divided by second, because it is hertz. So now it will give 1411200 bits per second. It will give this much bits per second, and if we convert it into kilobyte, the value will be like 172 kilobyte per second, okay. So this is the value of this file. Now in the MP3 file, compression is made at 128 kilobit or 16 kilobytes per second. So for the MP3 audio files, compression is made at 16 kilobyte per seconds, okay. So this is the actual compression. So now we can divide this as, because we have to find the compression ratio here. So 172 kilobytes per second divided by 16 kilobytes per second, so it will give the value around 10.75:1. This is the compression ratio. So the answer will be 10:1 will be the, because we are doing here, we are taking the round figure 10. So 10:1 is a typical MP3 audio files compression ratio. So this is the answer.